15 times and has out-earned him by more than $100,000. Dale Jr. won his first Winston Cup race on April 2nd in the DirecTV 500. His father was waiting for him in the winner's circle to congratulate him.
I got to Victor Lane before he ever got there and was waiting on him. That was a big time to see a brand new race team, and your son win his first Winston Cup race.
The Earnhardts weren't always this close. While Dale Jr. was growing up, Dale Sr. was often absent, either working in the garage or on the road.
He was racing a lot, so he really wasn't there to do the, hey, clean your room, brush your teeth, you know, get up for school kind of thing. He never really got around to giving me direction till I started racing.
Today, Dale Jr. competes against his father, but also works for him, driving one of his cars.
If we're racing and I hang him out to dry or something to finish in the top five or to win the race, you know, he gets a cut of that check too, so he can't be too disappointed.
But he can. And one thing Dale Jr. is finding out about racing against his father is just how much the elder Earnhardt hates to lose.
He's frustrated if he's not running in the top four. And it has nothing really to do with I outran him or out, you know, I beat him. He's just frustrated if he's not running up front because he feels like that's where he needs to be and where he should be.
Whether it's him or who, I don't like to run second, but sometimes you do, and you just got to pick it up and go again.
Dale Jr. also believes that he has heredity on his side.
Whether people believe it or not, the man can damn near see behind him. And I think that I've acquired a good percentage of that trait, and being aware of things moving that you can't see. And that's good to have and good to know on the racetrack because there's a lot of blind spots.
Three of Earnhardt's children have inherited their father's passion for racing. Daughter Kelly raced late model stock cars for 3 years before she decided to go into the marketing side of the business. His oldest son, Kerry, competes on the ARCA circuit, also in an Earnhardt-owned car. But before outfitting them with the best cars, Dale Sr. made his children learn the business on their own.
And the only thing he did was lay the newspaper down in front of us, of an article of a new series starting out at a local track of ours, and said, this is something y'all ought to try to get involved in. And so I had a go-kart and I sold it. And me and my brother took the money from that and bought the stuff we needed to race.
Yeah, he had a go-kart he sold for like $500, and I had some odds and ends I had together. We sold and got all the money together to buy the street stock from the junkyard.
He made sure it was safe. You know, he made sure the cars we drove were safe, and from there on out, it was our business what we did with them.
I mean, in terms of what Dale and Kerry say about getting help is the same thing. I mean, I didn't get that help either, but it was a way for him to get me to move home from college, to say, you know, come on, you know, we'll get you racing at Concord in the street stocks. And so, and when I got here and started doing that, well, that was the end of, you know, the help from him.
It's hard. I guess that's his way of raising me and allowing me to learn the hard way. You know, there were times where he just walked by and see me, and I knew I wasn't doing it right, but I didn't know what to do, any other way to do it different. And it just could have been maybe a little easier, but I mean, that's probably, I probably wouldn't have turned out the way I am now.
I wanted them to go out and be what they wanted to be, really. And at the end of the day, it was racing for Kerry and Dale Jr. And so now that we've made a commitment to it, yeah, we try to give them the best of everything in racing. It's working out pretty good.
But the sport that drew Dale Sr. away from his children while they were growing up is what has brought them closer together as adults. Dale Jr. and his father are making up for lost time.
The past 4 or 5 years have been a lot of fun. Get to know him, getting to be close to him, finding out how much he cares about me and the rest of the kids, and how much he cares about his racing, how much he cares about our well-being, how much he cares about our success, how much he cares about his marriage. You know, I mean, find out those things about him, you really can get a good sense of what kind of person he is.
Thank you, Jeremy Schaff, for that report. That is a live shot of Daytona, Florida, the Daytona International Speedway. And when we come back here on ESPN News, we will talk with our reporter Mike Massaro with more reaction on the death of Dale Earnhardt Sr. Stay with us.
Joins us now live from Daytona. And Mike, the immediate question that comes to mind for you is, in the frenzy to cover Michael Waltrip's first Winston Cup victory in 463 career starts, did you at the raceway know how serious Dale Earnhardt Sr.'s condition was, considering Dr. Steve Bohannon told us earlier that he thinks Earnhardt Sr. died almost immediately?
Well, it was tough to get a handle, Steve, on how serious it was. We were in victory lane, and it was weird because the emotion swing was so dramatic. Within a 5-minute span, the emotions went from elation to totally depressed. The rumors began to swirl around the media center that it was serious, that Dale Earnhardt was taken to the Halifax Medical Center just down the road from the Daytona International Speedway, and that he was not conscious when he was taken out of the race car. He was cut out of the race car. Actually, Ken Schrader, who was involved in the accident, was at the scene. He pulled down the window net, and he was the first to motion to the safety team for them to come over and take a look at Dale Earnhardt.
Mike, can you tell us what's going on at the track right now? Sort of paint a picture for us. It just must be a very surreal experience.
It is very surreal. That's a great way to describe it. This morning, it was electric. Fans were just trickling in by the thousands. Now there really aren't very many fans here, but it seems that there's more media here than there were for the actual race. It's very somber, a very dark day for NASCAR.
All right, Mike Massaro, thank you very much. We appreciate it. We'll check back with you later here on ESPN News. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Steve.
Dale Earnhardt Sr., a 7-time Winston Cup champion, dead at the age of 49. We will have much more as ESPN News continues. Stay with us.
Forever. And I personally have lost a great friend.
Hello there. Welcome to ESPN News, your 24-hour source for all things sports. Along with Neil Everett, I'm Betsy Ross, and a heartbreaking day today at Daytona.
Yeah, 7-time Winston Cup champion Dale Earnhardt, could almost see the checkered flag, gets into an accident on turn number 4 and passes away. Well, with the new rules promoting more passing, they were predicting one of the best Daytona 500s ever today. Instead, it is the death of a legend that overshadows a Cinderella finish. Dale Earnhardt Sr. is dead at the age of 49. The 7-time Winston Cup champion died from injuries he sustained in a crash at Daytona today, just a half mile from the checkered flag. Dale Earnhardt was 49 years old. He leaves behind a wife and 4 children. Earnhardt in the black number 3 Chevy, bumped by Sterling Marlin. The Intimidator's back end floats. Kenny Schrader's Pontiac broadsides the Chevy. It's headed into the wall at top speed. And the doctors that attended to Dale Earnhardt Sr. said that he was probably dead on impact.
That's all the news we have. He had blood in his airway, and he had blood in the ears that we see with basilar skull fractures. But really, no other external evidence of trauma, no.
I'm sorry, could you repeat your name again, please?
Steve Bohannon.
Folks, there's no question this is a very difficult time. I think Bill France's quote that the Speedway and NASCAR will put out here in a second sums it up for the moment. There'll be other press conferences and other opportunities to answer questions as we get more answers. But his quote is that NASCAR has lost its greatest driver ever. And I personally have lost a great friend. And that's Bill France's quote. And I think that pretty well sums it up for the NASCAR community right now.
Dale Earnhardt, tied with the King, is the winningest driver in Winston Cup history. His last Winston Cup win was at Talladega on October 15th of last year. He was second in the points race last year. He has 76 all-time Winston Cup wins and is your all-time winningest drivers in terms of money with over $41 million. Let's go to Mike Helton, NASCAR president, for a statement.
But after the accident in turn 4 at the end of the Daytona 500, we've lost Dale Earnhardt. And I have with me Dr. Steve Bohannon, who's a trauma doctor here in Daytona that's worked several events here at the Speedway, and he can explain the medical practice that went on at the accident scene and over to the hospital. In a timing issue, we're here to tell you what we know. We don't know a lot. We don't know enough to answer all your questions. Our prayers and wishes and our effort right now, this moment, is with Teresa and the Earnhardt family.
We're joined now by ESPN's Mike Massaro, who's at Daytona. And Mike, it's got to be surreal. What is the mood down there right now?
Well, Neil, as you might imagine, it's extremely somber here in Daytona this morning. The excitement was in the air, and that has quickly gone away. In victory lane, the mood swung from elation for Michael Waltrip in his first victory in over 462 attempts to total devastation as we got word that NASCAR's greatest driver had passed away at the age of 49. Mike Helton gave us the word, along with Dr. Steve Bohannon, at about 6:30 that Dale Earnhardt was unconscious when they took him from the race car, and that it appeared that he may have died upon impact. There will be an autopsy tomorrow morning to find out for sure. This is absolutely devastating for NASCAR. Some people may actually argue that this loss is the equivalent to, say, a loss of a Michael Jordan in basketball or a Mark McGwire, say, in baseball. He was simply the greatest ever to put a helmet on and go around this racetrack or any other racetrack on the NASCAR circuit. We've already talked about the stats: 7 championships, 76 wins. That places him 6th on the all-time list. The irony is that he lost his life here at Daytona, a track that really gave him a status larger than life. He won 34 races here, more than any other driver in history, and it looked as though he could have competed for his 35th win today. That is even the greatest irony. I think anybody that knows Dale Earnhardt knows he's about one thing. It's about winning. But today it appeared that he may have been holding back, being a little bit selfish, trying to allow his son, Dale Earnhardt Jr., and his new employee, Michael Waltrip, the chance to dice it up for a Daytona 500 victory. In the process, it cost him his life. The irony I see was that if he was actually going for the win, this may not have happened.
They say that Michael Waltrip was like a little brother to Dale Earnhardt Sr., who had no brothers or no younger brothers that I'm aware of. How long into the celebration did it become apparent that the seriousness of Dale Earnhardt Sr.'s injuries would cut short the celebration of Michael Waltrip winning Daytona today?
Well, when Michael Waltrip got out of the race car, he jumped up on the hood and was as excited as you might imagine he would be, but it took maybe about 3 or 4 minutes before he got word that Dale Earnhardt had sustained a very serious injury. He walked over to the podium to make a comment for the media, and all of a sudden his mood swung, like I mentioned, from elation to total devastation. It didn't take very long, and of course the word spread around here like wildfire.
Mike, they talk about the safety issues really comes into the play in the 18-car pileup that they're talking about, the aerodynamic packages, where nobody was hurt, sans Tony Stewart, who suffered a concussion and a sore shoulder. Where do you see safety issues, the safety talk going because of that wreck, and then also because of what happened to Earnhardt Sr.?
Well, of course, for those folks out there who aren't aware, this is the 4th loss of life in NASCAR's community in less than 12 months. And because of that, NASCAR has taken a very serious look into safety issues on these race cars. At New Hampshire last year, after 2 deaths occurred there, they mandated restrictor plates, which slowed the race cars down. Also, another device that many teams are looking at is the Hans device, which restricts the head rock when a car actually makes impact with a wall. And that's supposed to help. A lot of drivers are going about it upon their own will to take advantage of that device. However, it is not mandated in NASCAR. However, in other series, like the F1 series and the kart series this year, it is mandatory that they run the Hans device. Kind of ironic, again, I spoke with Dale Earnhardt in Las Vegas just 3 weeks ago about the Hans device to get his opinion, and he said what a lot of veterans are saying. He just didn't like it. It wasn't comfortable, and he wasn't going to change.
Mike Massaro, thank you for joining us on ESPN News.
Thank you.
In 1997, Dale Earnhardt's car flipped wildly on the backstretch near the end of that Daytona 500 in 1997, but he was able to walk away not seriously hurt. Well, somehow you expected the same result this time. Earnhardt squeezing out of the window of his car, waving to the crowd, celebrating his own driver's win. This time, it was not to be. NASCAR Chairman Bill France Jr. said he had lost a great friend. Now, most of the racing community and the fans feel the same way. Here's Mike Gleason.
Earnhardt finally is a champion of the Daytona 500.
The Intimidator. I remember my first year down at IROC in Daytona, and he was standing by one of the trucks, and he's got his glasses on, and he's got his arms crossed, and he's just watching everybody walk by and stuff. And I went up and stood next to him, and what are you doing? And he goes, I'm just looking at everybody.
Dale Earnhardt was born to stock car racing in Kannapolis, North Carolina in 1951. His father, Ralph, was the 1956 NASCAR Sportsman Division champion and a popular man in the Winston Cup garage. Ralph died in 1973 while working on his car. For Dale, racing wasn't a way of life. It was life.
That's all I ever knew. I never did play ball. I never did do anything much in school other than hurried and got home and seen what was going on with the race cars. And it was a unique childhood. And that's why I think the love of racing and my drive to race was so strong when I started is that's what I knew. That's what I grew up doing. And it's like I knew how to do it. Before. When I sat down in a race car, it was just natural.
As natural as it was very unrefined. When he arrived on the Winston Cup circuit full-time in 1979, he ruffled more than a few feathers and bent his fair share of sheet metal.
Very, very creep, like a diamond in the rough. It's one of those deals where you see some of them coming and you say, if he makes it, he's going to be okay, but if he keeps driving like this, he ain't going
to
make it.
I got into Richard at Martinsville. I remember one race that I got into the side of Richard going in one, but I did it from about 10 cars back from where I started, and I passed like five or six cars getting in the corner to get to Richard Petty. And I didn't do it to get to Richard Petty, but just Richard was in the way when I got there.
He tolerated it. The owners tolerated the wrecks and all that stuff, and some of the drivers tolerated some of the stuff that he did at that time, and it all worked out.
I was listening when they were scolding me. Richard Petty, too, when he was scolding me about driving over the curb into the side of his race car.
He was listening, and he was learning. In 1980, Earnhardt became the first driver to win Rookie of the Year and the Winston Cup Championship in back-to-back seasons. After driving for Rod Osterlund and Bud Moore, Earnhardt signed on with former independent driver Richard Childress. The early going was rough, but a dynasty was in the making.
84 was a little bit of a tough year. 85 was even a tougher year. We blew up a lot of engines. I think we won a race or two both years, but Richard told me, he said, man, this is not really working out, and you're a champion. You know, if you want to go do something else, feel free to. And I said, no, man, we'll stick this thing out. Well, we had 85 was a tough year. We turned the corner in 86, won a championship, and then we just went from there up. It just was amazing.
From 1986 to 1994, Earnhardt and Childress won six championships in 48 races. They had the best pit crew. They won on short tracks. They won on speedways. And Earnhardt's ability to master the draft became legend. The result was a fan frenzy and marketing machine that the sport has never seen. He copyrighted his name and signature and turned souvenir sales into a standalone booming business. His career was like an all-comers meet, beating the likes of Yarborough and Petty to Wallace and Elliott. Fans either loved him or hated him. There was no middle ground.
Dale Earnhardt came along when Richard Petty was going out, and we needed greatly a new superstar, and became a different kind of a hero than Richard Petty was. Became the Intimidator, Man in Black, and sold a lot of tickets for us. We got a lot of TV ratings up there.
But the Intimidator's Achilles heel was Daytona. He had won there more than any driver in history, but never in the Daytona 500. In 1998, on the 20th try, the sport's biggest star finally took the sport's biggest prize.
Been here a lot. This is the greatest time I've ever had in Victory Lane right here. This is it.
The Earnhardt name has gone from the dirt tracks of North Carolina to the title of a multi-million dollar racing corporation.
To win the championships and race against Petty and people that he raced against, and Yarborough and Pearson and these guys, it's pretty unique, pretty awesome thing. All I can remember or think about is that he would have enjoyed this so much as what we've accomplished and what we've done, and enjoyed the things I've done over time. And I'd like for him to have been along the whole ride. It would have been neat.
Dale Earnhardt tied with the King as the winningest driver in Winston Cup history. His last Winston Cup win at Talladega on October 15th of last year. Second in the points race last year, he has 76 all-time Winston Cup wins and is the all-time winningest in terms of money with over $41 million. Earnhardt died on the track where he has more victories than any other driver, 34. Dale Earnhardt Sr. was
49 years old.
Let's go to Daytona 500, show you how the action went today. Terry Bradshaw waving the flag to get things started. And there's Dale Earnhardt Sr. bumping teammate Mike Skinner. A little love touch then. They're a little more aggressive driving. That's what the Intimidator was synonymous with. Jeff Gordon and Earnhardt Sr. touch there. 26 laps to go. Robbie Gordon's Chevy touches Ward Burton's Dodge, nudges Tony Stewart's Pontiac, and we've got a problem. Stewart's got big problems.
I know it's happening so fast, but what is Tony Stewart?
18 cars involved in this, including Stewart's teammate Bobby Labonte, last year's points champion. He's finished. Ward Burton's car appeared to be one of the strongest. Gone. Last year's champion, Dale Jarrett, see you in the garage. Jason Leffler, one of five rookies unable to dodge in his Dodge. Let's take another look. Stewart's car looking like a bad circus ride. He reportedly was knocked out momentarily, later complained of shoulder soreness, did suffer from a concussion. Fortunate for him. Once again, 18 cars knocked out. The red flag comes out. A delay of almost 30 minutes would follow. 17 laps to go. Dale Earnhardt Sr. leading. Michael Waltrip, who drives for Earnhardt Sr., takes the lead. Final lap. Waltrip trying to hold off Dale Earnhardt Jr. Behind him, the accident that claimed the life of Dale Earnhardt Sr. as Michael Waltrip crosses the finish line first. And it's been forever and a day, 462 starts prior to today before Michael Waltrip wins his first Winston Cup race, and he wins the big one at Daytona. College basketball. During his team's victory over Duke earlier this month, North Carolina coach Matt Doyle.
My own business back in 1982.
Protecting the lead of Michael Waltrip and his son. Two cars touch. Earnhardt's number three and Ken Schrader launched to the fourth turn wall. Schrader climbed from the wreckage, walked over to Earnhardt's car, and called for paramedics. The race had ended. Waltrip had won. Earnhardt Jr. ran not to victory lane, but toward his father's car. Followed the ambulance to Halifax Medical Center.
Joining Mike Joy is Jeff Hammond and Ken Squire. Jeff Hammond, of course, former crew chief. You worked with Dale Earnhardt and competed against him many times.
Yeah, Chris, it's really kind of hard to say. I mean, I was fortunate enough to watch Dale get in his first car way back when we were racing at Concord, and his daddy was still helping Dale. And a competitor, I don't think I know of anybody I've ever been around. It epitomizes the word. The man was relentless as far as his competition was concerned. We had a lot of good times together. We raced together on those dirt tracks at home. We used to go to his place and ride in the back of his boat, go tubing together. We'd done some hunting together, but through all our relationship and friendship, he always was a competitor.
And did a lot for his sport. 27 years in Winston Cup racing. As you look at all of the accomplishments of Dale Earnhardt, former Rookie of the Year, and of course won Daytona 500 after so many years of trying to, back in 1998, it finally happened. Mike Joy, you called most of the races through his entire career, nicknamed the Intimidator, but it was hard not to like him if you met him.
You had to respect him. You had to like him. The compass of this sport has lost its true north. Dale Earnhardt defined the limits of on-track behavior, and every time he pushed that limit, the limit moved with him. But more importantly, Chris, he set the standard and the goals for every driver who followed him.
And Ken Squire, you saw all of his Daytona 500 performances. This was his 23rd consecutive start, and it's difficult to describe or put into words what Dale Earnhardt did for NASCAR racing.
Well, whatever stock car racing is, Dale Earnhardt was. He was the child in the back of a pickup truck at the Charlotte Motor Speedway with his dad, watching those cars in the 600 and dreaming someday of being in Winston Cup racing. He was the teenager whose equipment was a t-shirt and a crash helmet, bumming rides, building cars, trying to prove that he could handle those short tracks in the Carolinas just as well as his father, Ralph Earnhardt, did, who was a national champion. He was the guy that came along in 1979 and became Rookie of the Year in Winston Cup racing, and 1 year later was the Winston Cup national champion. And through it all, he seemed quiet. He became the intimidator, one who didn't have much to say, but who did it with his deeds on the racetrack. His wife, Teresa, changed a lot of that. He became much easier with the media. Until 1994, on this very track, just a few hundred feet from where he died today, his best friend in this world, Neil Bonnett, lost his life in a very similar type of crash. It seemed as if he went into a dark period for a bit. And then he's come out of it. 1997, nearly won the 500. It was right there. And then was upside down in the backstretch, refused to go to the medical center, got back in and drove the car around and finished the race. And then 1 year later, we saw him in victory lane. 20 years of effort in winning the race that meant the most to him, and there he was, up on top of the world. He told me in victory lane that day, yes, yes, 20 years. Can you believe it? Now we come to this point in his career. Going down the backstretch in the final lap, out in front, Michael Waltrip in one of his cars. His son is running in second place. And two of his colleagues, two of his racing pals, are right in there beside him going for a photo finish for third spot. There's Ken Schrader from Missouri on the outside. There's Sterling Marlin from Tennessee on the inside. And as they went into that turn and he saw what was coming about, I would consider that Dale Earnhardt died happy.
The irony of this, Mike Choi, is just that. Gave a chance to Michael Waltrip, who hadn't won in 462 races. His son finishing second, both cars owned by Dale Earnhardt, and competing to the very, very end.
Earnhardt had won this race. He knew the great joy of winning the 500. And Larry McReynolds, Darrell Waltrip, and I, calling those final laps, somehow knew that he would protect the lead of Waltrip and his son, let them fight it out among themselves, and may the best man win. And that's what he was doing when he and Sterling Marlin touched and Earnhardt went caroming off to the wall. It is such irony that the man who celebrates as the Daytona 500 champion can't have his car owner and benefactor share in that celebration.
I spoke with Dale Earnhardt this week. He said that after the neck surgery a couple of years ago, seeking that eighth Winston Cup title was very important to him, and he felt like he could drive for another 10 years or so. Unfortunately, that dream has been cut short. Dale Earnhardt, who would have turned 50 years old in April, has died on the final lap in the 43rd running of the Daytona 500.
Now, just moments ago, NASCAR legend Ned Jarrett from the Halifax Medical Center discussed whether or not NASCAR could have done anything to stop this tragedy from happening.
Well, I'm sure that NASCAR will take a close look, and they continue to look at things that can help to make it safer for the drivers. And they certainly look at every accident and try to learn from it, and they want the drivers to be safe. There are certain things that they don't make mandatory because it, you know, things like that really is the choice of the driver. You know, Dale Earnhardt didn't wear full face helmets, and that was his choice. And it's hard for a sanctioning body to mandate those kind of things when it's a personal choice of an individual to do certain things that others might not do. And I wouldn't say that had anything to do with what happened here today, but I'm sure that NASCAR will take a look at it, a deeper look, and if it is proven that the Hans or any other system can help to prevent those kind of things, well, they certainly would work with them to try to make it happen. Now,
that was Ned Jarrett, a NASCAR legend, speaking there on the death of Dale Earnhardt, who passed away today at the age of 49. I think that basically we're all pretty much numb right now, and we will have much more coming up tonight at 9 p.m. local time on NASCAR Victory Lane. That'll be followed up by the National Sports Report.
We now return you to
season, the sport's crown jewel, the Daytona 500. Instead, we mourn the passing of a seven-time Winston Cup champion and one of racing's most unique personalities. Dale Earnhardt was running third on Sunday behind his son, Dale Jr., and the man he hired to drive for him this year, race winner Michael Waltrip. They came to the final lap. Earnhardt hit the wall and was caught up with Ken Schrader, had to be cut out of his car, a process that took 5 to 10 minutes, and a tarp was drawn to cover the wreckage. He was taken to Halifax Medical Center in Daytona. A doctor on site there said that Earnhardt was unconscious and unresponsive and never showed any signs of life. An autopsy will determine the exact cause of death, but the doctor speculated that it was a head injury to the base of the skull. Mike Massaro is covering Speed Weeks for us, and again, what should have been a joyous day for Michael Waltrip has turned tragic. Not only did Waltrip drive for Dale Earnhardt, the two were very close friends. Mike, a very difficult time right now for NASCAR.
And I think that may be actually an understatement. The mood is extremely somber here in Daytona, and it was a wild mood swing in Victory Lane. It went from total elation to total devastation. Right now at Daytona, if you look behind me at International Speedway Boulevard, now normally after the Daytona 500, horns are blowing, people are yelling, people are partying, people are having a very good time. Right now, you could practically hear a pin drop. It's that quiet.
The impact of the loss, perhaps it's too early to really state what it means to not have Dale Earnhardt as part of the Winston Cup Series, but if you could, speak to the impact and also the irony involved here.
Well, Whit, it's such a dramatic impact. Dale Earnhardt, if you will, and I don't think I'm overstating this at all, is NASCAR's equivalent to, say, Michael Jordan, or, say, Mark McGwire in baseball. He had that much effect on this sport. He had 7 championships. He was 6th on the all-time win list with 76 victories. People simply came to the racetrack to either root for him or root against him. But no matter what you say about Dale Earnhardt, he was all about winning. He was an ambassador for this sport, and people really enjoyed having him around. There's no doubt that NASCAR can go on without him. They've lost champions in the past. Alan Kulwicki, Davey Allison both lost their lives after winning Winston Cup Series championships. But this sport will certainly be different next week at Rockingham.
At this point, we don't know the full extent of the injuries that caused the death of Dale Earnhardt. But surely it is not too early to start asking questions about safety issues in stock car racing. This has come up before, some of the deaths of drivers in years past that you touched on. Was there any mention made of, for example, the Hans device or any of the other safety precautions that perhaps could be taken in stock car racing?
Well, Whit, this was the 4th death on a racetrack in NASCAR in the last 12 months. Safety on the top of everybody's mind. The Hans device did come up in questioning of Dr. Steve Bohannon. He speculated, however, that it may not have made a difference. However, it just seems ironic. I had the chance to speak with Dale Earnhardt only 3 weeks ago in Las Vegas during a test about the Hans device, because so many drivers are experimenting with it these days. And Dale Earnhardt's response was, he's not going to use it. He doesn't like it. He's uncomfortable with it. And that's pretty much the stance of most of the veterans here in NASCAR. The Hans device has, I believe, become mandatory in Formula One and in the kart series, and right now is only beginning to catch on in popularity.
Mike Massaro in Daytona, a very tough day for everybody. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Whit.
Dale Earnhardt had 676 career starts in his career, had the 6th most wins in Winston Cup history, the 1979 Rookie of the Year, and he backed it up with his first of 7 Winston Cup titles in 1980. He led over 25,000 laps in his career. Known as the Intimidator, but Dale Earnhardt had many friends in racing. The side we didn't see when he was on the racetrack endeared him to those closest to him. Dr. Jerry Punch is with us on the show. And Doctor, first of all, thank you very much for taking the time. I know how difficult this is because you're very close to the family. But if you could, try to put into words what the loss will mean to the racing world.
Well, I'm not sure you can. I'm having a hard time just finding the words right now because Dale Earnhardt is hard to say was, but was one of my best friends for many, many years. You know, it's ironic that people talk about Dale Earnhardt and how selfish he was on the racetrack, how much he cared about himself on the racetrack, because he was a winner and he wanted to win when he buckled that helmet on. But those of us who knew him knew that he was really a very, very unselfish individual off the racetrack. And the irony is that today, for the first time that I can remember, and I've known this man a long, long time, you saw him be very, very unselfish in those final few laps. He had a car that could have made a move, in my opinion, following this sport for 20 years. He could have pulled up in front of Sterling Marlin, maybe Kenny Schrader, probably drafted by, and won his second Daytona 500. But what he did in those final laps was what a father would do for a son. Ironically, that was his son right in front of him, Dale Earnhardt Jr., or what a brother would do for a brother. And Michael Waltrip was like the little brother that he didn't have. And he stayed there and ran 185 mile per hour screen as a pick, and he kept Sterling Marlin back there and Kenny Schrader and those guys who didn't get a chance to get up there and fight for the win, so that his two people in front of him, his son and one of his best friends, Michael Waltrip, who he had given a chance, did have a chance. And so it was very, very unselfish of Dale Earnhardt. And it's a move that many of us who've known him for years would understand. But it's very difficult now to understand because he's gone.
Now, Doctor, again, we want to stress that we do not have the full details of the injuries to Dale Earnhardt and what precisely caused his death. But in light of the recent stories regarding safety in NASCAR and in all forms of racing, there's been talk about the Hans device, which is now mandatory on ovals in kart, also mandatory in F1 racing. Do we now need to take, yet again, a closer look at issues of safety, protecting the drivers in stock car racing?
Well, I mean, in my opinion, NASCAR racing is the safest form of racing in all of sports, all of motorsports. There's nothing safer than those race cars and inch and three-quarter roll bar tubing. We saw Jeffrey Bodine's horrific tumble at Daytona last year in the truck race. We saw a tumble for Tony Stewart today, an 18-car crash in the Daytona 500. The drivers walked away. Stewart was taken to the hospital and checked out and basically is going to be okay. What you can't predict is what happened with Dale Earnhardt, what we saw happen with Neil Bonnett a few years ago, what happened with Ernie Irvin at Michigan back in 1994, the abrupt right-hand turn up into the wall and almost head-on collision, that deceleration. In my opinion, I mean, the Hans device is a great device, and it's very difficult to talk about safety devices when we're talking about the loss of someone that we all cared about so much. But I'm not so sure the Hans device or anything at that point in time would, even as safe as these cars are, would have made that much difference with that kind of massive deceleration at 185 miles an hour. Because typically you get a fracture involving in the head, and those are not survivable injuries. The injuries that are the accidents that look the worst, and people say it didn't look that bad, but the injuries that are the ones that are the survivable are the violent tumbles, because those are the ones where you dissipate enough injury and you may have a broken bone or two and a concussion, but these are the bad ones, the ones where you suddenly stop and veer directly into a wall.
Dr. Jerry Punch, again, I know it's been a very difficult day for you. Thank you very much for your time. Dale Earnhardt won his first Winston Cup championship in 1980 and 1994, tied the king with his seventh Winston Cup title, and no other driver has more than three. Earnhardt's seven titles came over a 14-year span. When we come back, the lighter side of the man in black, a personality remembered, a personality that you may not know.
The championship, I tell you, the 50th anniversary of NASCAR. Who would have believed I could win the Daytona 500 and the 50th anniversary of Daytona, our 20th year here? We're going on winning that championship. Heck with a popular driver. I'd rather be a champion.
1,785 grandstand seats at Daytona International Speedway were sold out. It made for the largest crowd in the history of the track, and they got more than they bargained for on Sunday. A backstretch wreck took out 18 cars late in the race. Ward Burton, Tony Stewart, Bobby Labonte, Dale Jarrett, and Mark Martin among those involved. And then, on the final lap, the accident that claimed the life of Dale Earnhardt. A very fast race until that point, and Michael Waltrip did win for the first time in 463 career Winston Cup starts. His previous best finish at this race, fifth, in 1999. Dale Earnhardt Jr. was second, Ricky Rudd fourth, Bill Elliott started on the pole and took his Dodge home fifth. Sterling Marlin, also in a Dodge, came around in seventh, one of the faster cars on the track Sunday. Stacy Compton, 10th in a Dodge. Earnhardt was given credit for a 12th place finish. Ken Schrader, 13th. Robert Presley, a good showing in 14th. Winston Cup Series rookie Ron Hornaday 17th, just ahead of Elliot Sadler in a Ford. Many of the cars in the back of the pack not running or several laps down thanks to that huge wreck with about 40 laps to go. Jeff Burton 19th, Casey Atwood the rookie 20th, Dale Jarrett among those whose day was cut short by the first major accident. Mike Skinner led the 500 for several laps on Sunday. Johnny Benson, a victim of engine failure. Jeff Gordon also collected in the first accident. Steve Park, also a driver for Dale Earnhardt, finishing 31st. Jerry Nadeau with a top 10 start but fell back with the first accident. Mark Martin also collected. Jason Leffler could not avoid it either. He finished 34th. Tony Stewart, you saw his name. He was taken to Halifax Medical Center, treated for a concussion and a shoulder injury. His teammate Bobby Labonte involved in the same mishap, the defending Winston Cup champion finishing in 40th. Jeff Purvis was the first to exit the race, 49 lead changes among 14 drivers. That's a staggering number. Three cautions for 14 laps and the average speed just under 162 miles per hour. A great champion has left us. More on the life and career of Dale Earnhardt when RPM continues.
There's no additional charge for this service. To enroll, just use the back of your DirecTV.
North Carolina in 1951. He lived there as an adult. He was born into racing, as were his children. A Rookie of the Year in 1979, a Winston Cup champion in 1980, and six times more. Mike Gleason has a look at the life and legacy of Dale Earnhardt.
Earnhardt finally is a champion of the Daytona 500.
The Intimidator. I remember my first year down at IROC in Daytona, and he was standing by one of the trucks, and he's got his glasses on, and he's got his arms crossed, and he's just watching everybody walk by and stuff. And I went up and stood next to him, and what are you doing? And he goes, I'm just looking at everybody.
Dale Earnhardt was born to stock car racing in Kannapolis, North Carolina in 1951. His father, Ralph, was the 1956 NASCAR Sportsman Division champion and a popular man in the Winston Cup garage. Ralph died in 1973 while working on his car. For Dale, racing wasn't a way of life. It was life.
That's all I ever knew. I never did play ball. I never did do anything much in school other than hurry and got home and seen what was going on with the race cars. And it was a unique childhood. And that's why I think the love of racing and my drive to race was so strong when I started is that's what I knew. That's what I grew up doing. And it's like I knew how to do it. Before. When I sat down in a race car, it was just natural.
As natural as it was very unrefined. When he arrived on the Winston Cup circuit full time in 1979, he ruffled more than a few feathers and bent his fair share of sheet metal.
Very, very crude, like a diamond in the rough. It's one of those deals where you see some of them coming and you say, if he makes it, he's gonna be okay, but if he keeps driving like this, he ain't gonna make it.
I got in to Richard at Martinsville. I remember one race that I got into the side of Richard going in one, but I did it from about 10 cars back from where I started, and I passed like five or six cars getting in the corner to get to Richard Petty. And I didn't do it to get to Richard Petty, but just Richard was in the way when I got there.
He tolerated it. The owners tolerated the wrecks and all that stuff, and some of the drivers tolerated some of the stuff that he did at that time, and it all worked out.
I was listening when they were scolding me. Richard Petty, too, when he was scolding me about driving over the curb into the side of his race car.
He was listening, and he was learning. In 1980, Earnhardt became the first driver to win Rookie of the Year and the Winston Cup Championship in back-to-back seasons. After driving for Rod Osterlund and Bud Moore, Earnhardt signed on with former independent driver Richard Childress. The early going was rough, but a dynasty was in the making.
84 was a little bit of a tough year. 85 was even a tougher year. We blew up a lot of engines. I think we won a race or two both years, but Richard told me, he said, man, this is not really working out, and you're a champion. You know, if you want to go do something else, feel free to. And I said, no, man, we'll stick this thing out. We had 85 was a tough year. We turned the corner in 86 and won a championship. And then we just went from there up. It just was amazing.
From 1986 to 1994, Earnhardt and Childress won six championships in 48 races. They had the best pit crew. They won on short tracks. They won on speedways. And Earnhardt's ability to master the draft became legend. The result was a fan frenzy and marketing machine that the sport has never seen. He copyrighted his name and signature and turned souvenir sales into a standalone booming business. His career was like an all-comers meet, beating the likes of Yarborough and Petty to Wallace and Elliott. Fans either loved him or hated him. There was no middle ground.
Dale Earnhardt came along when Richard Petty was going out, and we needed greatly a new superstar, and became a different kind of a hero than Richard Petty was. Became the Intimidator, the Man in Black, and sold a lot of tickets for us. We got a lot of TV ratings up there.
But the Intimidator's Achilles heel was Daytona. He had won there more than any driver in history, but never in the Daytona 500. In 1998, on the 20th try, the sport's biggest star finally took the sport's biggest prize.
Been here a lot. This is the greatest time I've ever had in Victor Lane right here. This is it.
The Earnhardt name has gone from the dirt tracks of North Carolina to the title of a multi-million dollar racing corporation.
To win the championships and race against Petty and people that he raced against, and Yarborough and Pearson and these guys, it's pretty unique, pretty awesome thing. All I can remember or think about is that he would have enjoyed this so much as what we've accomplished and what we've done, and enjoyed things I've done over time. And I'd like for him to have been along the whole ride. It would have been neat.
Dale Earnhardt leaves us with 76 career victories, good for sixth on the all-time list. He won races in 20 of his 22 full-time Winston Cup seasons, including a career-high 11 wins in his championship season of 1987. Still to come on RPM tonight, the lighter side of number three, a side that many of us never got a chance to see.
So ESPN.com.
That he dominated. He won 12 Twin 125 races, 7 Busch races, 6 Bud shootouts, 6 IROC races, 2 Pepsi 400s, and 1 very memorable Daytona 500 3 years ago. No other driver has even come close to his dominance at Daytona. One of our former ESPN colleagues tells a great story about Dale Earnhardt. Last year, the Man in Black was being interviewed on a rather serious topic, something about happy hour speeds or his qualifying effort that weekend. And while the reporter was attempting to maintain a calm demeanor, Earnhardt was very subtly, out of camera range, stomping down hard on the reporter's foot. He had a mischievous side, something that few of us ever saw. And we celebrate that aspect of Dale Earnhardt with this look back, an interview he did with Kenny Mayne a couple of years ago after he finally won the Daytona 500.
The good news is you won. The bad news is they took your car away, right?
That's fine. They can have it. We'll build a brand new 31. This 31 race is better than all of them put together.
I want to say
better than all of them.
How about the SB2 engine? I just wanted to justify my position.
That Monte Carlo, that brand new engine, come out with a brand new engine, come there and win the Daytona 500. That's what I've been needing all along.
But the broken push rod yesterday afternoon had to be a little concern.
It was a concern, Benny, but it was our fault that it broke. Oh, it was not the engine. It was our fault. We did something when we was pumping the engine. Spinny Clinton and the guys, they said, hey, we got a good engine. We got a good engine. They had a good engine. It's going to be in the museum for a year.
You had so many emotions in Victory Lane. I heard you talking about your dad, how special it was
to your dad.
And T. Wayne Robertson you missed, and Neil Bonnet. I mean, so many people you'd like to be able to share that with.
That's true. Ralph Earnhardt, I know, has got to be smiling. The gods smile down on us today. I mean, all of them. Like I said before, all the fans giving me, you know, this is your year. Hey, Ralph Earnhardt, Neil Bonnet, T. Wayne Robertson, this is all for you guys.
Hey, what do you do after this? Obviously, tomorrow's the big ceremony, but are you going to be appearing on some shows if the calls are flooded in?
If they book us, we may go on Oprah or whatever, but I don't know. We're we're going to go do Daytona USA tomorrow and put the car in the museum. Tuesday, I'm going to L.A. and do a new movie. I'm in a movie. Yeah, Gordon's
You're
not,
in a movie.
I am. whatever. You want to be in a movie?
Yeah, I'll go with you.
Anyway, we're gonna have a big week. I'm sure we're gonna get on Lilo. Who knows? I'm gonna go to California. I'll just call him up.
That sounds like a lot of fun. But you got a race to get ready for too.
Rockingham. That's Friday. I'll be there.
Just gonna show up Friday. You got some other things to do in advance of it.
Going to California, shoot a movie, be on Lilo, do this, do that.
What's the movie?
Oh, it's a secret.
But you're already thinking about Rockingham. You mentioned to me just a moment ago that you're going to go to Rockingham and win number two this season.
That's right. We got a good combination for there. The spoiler change, I think, is going to work for us and work with us. And I think the Taurus is going to be strong there. I really do. So we're gonna have work cut out for us. We'll go out and win it. But the Daytona 500, guys.
Hey, Dale, it's this morning. We said the three things you wanted before your career was over was a Daytona 500, which you got today, an eighth championship, and the most popular driver award. And I said if you won the 500 today, you're well on your way to number two and number three. How about it?
That's true. And the championship, I tell you, the 50th anniversary of NASCAR. Who would have believed I could win the Daytona 500 and the 50th anniversary of Daytona, our 20th year here. We're going on winning that championship. Heck with a popular driver. I'd rather be a champion.
Well, he's certainly a popular choice all around America. Dale, appreciate you very much for coming on,
spending time
with us.
Thank you, guys.
All right.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
Let's go to Rockingham.
Dale Earnhardt leaves behind his wife and four children, ranging in age from 12 to 31, including his sons, drivers, Kerry and Dale Jr., who runs number 8 in honor of his grandfather. Dale Earnhardt, husband, father, champion, dead at 49.
Kobe, Bubala, do you comprehend the power you have right there in your hands? Heir apparent? This is mega, baby. The next big thing. Now.
4 p.m. tonight, a one-hour special on the life and times of Dale Earnhardt. That's on ESPN2. ESPN Classic next Saturday, 12 hours of Earnhardt. That's next Saturday. I'm Whit Watson. Thank you for joining us. To Dale Earnhardt's friends and family, peace.
It's Sunday night in Cincinnati, and
there's another paramedic in the window with him, helping maintain the C-spine, holding the head. There were a number of firefighters that were on top of the car attempting to remove the roof, which was subsequently done. That took about 5 or 10 minutes, during which time we did CPR. When the roof came off, Dr. Allison and I both identified this was a very bad situation, a load-and-go situation. He had what I feel were life-ending type injuries at the time of impact, and really nothing could be done for him. He never showed any signs of life and subsequently was pronounced dead by all the physicians in attendance at 1716. His wife was there at the bedside.
NASCAR has lost its greatest driver ever, and I personally have lost a great friend. And that's Bill France's quote, and I think that pretty well sums it up for the NASCAR community right now.
Dale Earnhardt, tied with the King, Richard Petty, is the winningest driver in Winston Cup history. His last Winston Cup win was at Talladega in October of last year. He was second in the points race also last year. He has 76 all-time Winston Cup wins, and in terms of money, he was the man with over $41 million earned.
In 1997, Dale Earnhardt's car flipped wildly on the backstretch near the end of that Daytona 500 4 years ago, but he was able to walk away not seriously hurt. Well, somehow you expected the same result this time. Earnhardt squeezing out of the window of his car, waving to the crowd, celebrating his own driver's win. This time, though, it was not to be. NASCAR Chairman Bill France Jr. said he had lost a great friend. Most of the racing community and the fans feel the same way tonight. Here's Mike Gleason.
John Hart finally is a champion of the Daytona 500.
The Intimidator. I remember my first year down at IROC in Daytona, and he was standing by one of the trucks, and he's got his glasses on, and he's got his arms crossed, and he's just watching everybody walk by and stuff. And I went up and stood next to him, and what are you doing? And he goes, I'm just looking at everybody.
Dale Earnhardt was born to stock car racing in Kannapolis, North Carolina in 1951. His father, Ralph, was the 1956 NASCAR Sportsman Division champion and a popular man in the Winston Cup garage. Ralph died in 1973 while working on his car. For Dale, racing wasn't a way of life. It was life.
That's all I ever knew. I never did play ball. I never did do anything much in school other than hurry and got home and seen what was going on with the race cars. And it was a unique childhood, and that's why.
Good evening, everyone. I'm John Roberts, and this is a special edition of NASCAR Victory Lane. Today, seven-time Winston Cup champion Dale Earnhardt died at the age of 49, doing what he loved best, and that's driving a race car as hard as he could to the finish line. It was a day of triumph and tragedy for Dale Earnhardt Incorporated. His driver, Michael Waltrip, won the 500, and on the final lap of today's race, a collision with the wall took Earnhardt's life. A little more than an hour ago, Chris Myers and the Fox Sports Racing team filed this report from trackside in Daytona.
Seven-time Winston Cup champion and former Daytona 500 winner Dale Earnhardt has died from a crash suffered in Sunday's Daytona 500. The accident occurred on the final lap of Sunday's race. The tragic news came Sunday night, 2 hours after the race ended, from NASCAR President Mike Helton.
This is undoubtedly one of the toughest announcements that I've ever personally had to make. But after the accident in turn four at the end of the Daytona 500, we've lost Dale Earnhardt. And I have with Dr. Steve Bohannon, who's a trauma doctor here in Daytona that worked several events here at the Speedway, and he can explain the medical practice that went on at the accident scene and over to the hospital. In a timing issue, we're here to tell you what we know. We don't know a lot. We don't know enough to answer all your questions.
Our prayers and wishes and our effort right now, this moment, is with Teresa and the Earnhardt family. Richard Childress and his family, and Dale Earnhardt Incorporated. But I'll have Dr. Bohannon take it from here for right now.
I was on one of the ambulances that responded to the accident. I was about the third or fourth ambulance in. When I arrived, there were a number of paramedics already attending to him. There was a paramedic in through the passenger window, applying oxygen by a mask. Dr. Tim Allison, who's a trauma surgeon from Flagler County, was in through the driver's window and was delivering CPR. And there was another paramedic in the window with him helping maintain the C-spine holding the head. There were a number of firefighters that were on top of the car attempting to remove the roof, which was subsequently done. That took about 5 or 10 minutes, during which time We did CPR. When the roof came off, Dr. Allison and I both identified this was a very bad situation, a load and go situation. We immediately removed him and transported him to the area level 2 trauma center, Halifax Hospital. Transport time was about a minute to a minute and a half, during which time we continued CPR. There was a full trauma team there to meet him, a trauma neurosurgeon, Dr. Bill Kuhn, trauma surgeon, Dr. Demiuga. There were several emergency room doctors there as well. We all did everything we could for him. And additionally, there was an anesthesiologist who helped us maintain the airway. But he had what I feel were life-ending type injuries at the time of impact, and really nothing could be done for him.
Dale Earnhardt would have been 50 in April. The man who was NASCAR racing with 76 Winston Cup victories is survived by his wife, Teresa, four children, Kerry, Kelly King, Taylor Nicole, and Dale Earnhardt Jr., who finished second in Sunday's Daytona 500 behind Michael Waltrip, both cars owned by Dale Earnhardt. I'm joined now by Mike Joy, who called Sunday's Daytona 500 on Fox.
Well, Chris, the pre-race was a very relaxing time for Dale Earnhardt. He was relaxing in his interviews and chose to spend that time in the morning with family and with friends, laughing, joking, cajoling the folks that he'd go out and race against in today's Daytona 500. New hire Michael Waltrip. Wife Teresa, son Dale Jr. On the final lap, he was racing for third, protecting the lead of Michael Waltrip and his son. Two cars touch, Earnhardt's number three, and Ken Schrader launched to the fourth turn wall. Schrader climbed from the wreckage, walked over to Earnhardt's car, and called for paramedics. The race had ended. Waltrip had won. Earnhardt Jr. ran not to victory lane, but toward his father's car. He followed the ambulance to Halifax Medical Center.
Joining Mike Joy is Jeff Hammond and Ken Squire. Jeff Hammond, of course, former crew chief. You worked with Dale Earnhardt and competed against him many times.
Yeah, Chris, it's really kind of hard to say. I mean, I was fortunate enough to watch Dale get in his first car way back when we were racing at Concord, and his daddy was still helping Dale. And a competitor I don't think I know of anybody I've ever been around. It epitomizes the word. The man was relentless as far as his competition was concerned. We had a lot of good times together. We raced together on those dirt tracks at home. We used to go to his place and ride in the back of his boat, go tubing together. We'd done some hunting together, but through all our relationship and friendship, he always was a competitor.
And did a lot for his sport. 27 years in Winston Cup racing. As you look at all of the accomplishments of Dale Earnhardt, former Rookie of the Year, and of course won Daytona 500 after so many years of trying to, back in 1998 it finally happened. Mike Joy, you called most of the races through his entire career, nicknamed the Intimidator, but it was hard not to like him if you met him.
You had to respect him. You had to like him. The compass of this sport has lost its true north. Dale Earnhardt defined the limits of on-track behavior, and every time he pushed that limit, the limit moved with him. But more importantly, Chris, he set the standard and the goals for every driver who followed him.
And Ken Squire, you saw all of his Daytona 500 performances. This was his 23rd consecutive start, and it's difficult to describe or put into words what Dale Earnhardt did for NASCAR racing.
Well, whatever stock car racing is, Dale Earnhardt was. He was the child in the back of a pickup truck at the Charlotte Motor Speedway with his dad, watching those cars in the 600 and dreaming someday of being in Winston Cup racing. He was the teenager whose equipment was a T-shirt and a crash helmet, bumming rides, building cars, trying to prove that he could handle those short tracks in the Carolinas just as well as his father, Ralph Earnhardt, did, who was a national champion. He was the guy that came along in 1979 and became Rookie of the Year in Winston Cup racing, and 1 year later was the Winston Cup national champion. And through it all, he seemed quiet. He became the intimidator, one who didn't have much to say, but who did it with his deeds on the racetrack. His wife, Teresa, changed a lot of that. He became much easier with the media. Until 1994, on this very track, just a few hundred feet from where he died today, his best friend in this world, Neil Bonnett, lost his life in a very similar type of crash. It seemed as if he went into a dark period for a bit. And then he's come out of it. 1997, nearly won the 500. It was right there. And then was upside down in the backstretch, refused to go to the medical center, got back in and drove the car around and finished the race. And then 1 year later, we saw him in victory lane. 20 years of effort in winning the race that meant the most to him, and there he was, up on top of the world. He told me in victory lane that day, yes, yes, 20 years. Can you believe it? Now we come to this point in his career. Going down the backstretch in the final lap, out in front, Michael Waltrip in one of his cars. His son is running in second place. And two of his colleagues, two of his racing pals, are right in there beside him going for a photo finish for third spot. There's Ken Schrader from Missouri on the outside. There's Sterling Marlin from Tennessee on the inside. And as they went into that turn and he saw what was coming about, I would consider that Dale Earnhardt died happy.
The irony of this, Mike Joy, is just that. Gave a chance to Michael Waltrip, who hadn't won in 462 races. His son finishing second, both cars owned by Dale Earnhardt, and competing to the very, very end.
Earnhardt had won this race. He knew the great joy of winning the 500. And Larry McReynolds, Darrell Waltrip, and I, calling those final laps, somehow knew that he would protect the lead of Waltrip and his son, let them fight it out among themselves, and may the best man win. And that's what he was doing when he and Sterling Marlin touched and Earnhardt went caroming off to the wall. It is such irony that the man who celebrates as the Daytona 500 champion can't have his car owner and benefactor share in that celebration.
I spoke with Dale Earnhardt this week. He said that after the neck surgery a couple of years ago, seeking that eighth Winston Cup title was very important to him, and he felt like he could drive for another 10 years or so. Unfortunately, that dream has been cut short. Dale Earnhardt, who would have turned 50 years old in April, has died on the final lap in the 43rd running of the Daytona 500.
We'll have more on the tragic death of Dale Earnhardt when this special edition of NASCAR Victory Lane continues after the break. Back, everyone, to this special edition of NASCAR Victory Lane. What a day of mixed emotions it was at the Daytona International Speedway today. While Michael Waltrip was winning the pinnacle race of his career, the Daytona 500, his car owner, Dale Earnhardt, was sliding into the wall where he died at the age of 49. Joining me now is former Daytona 500 champion and veteran Winston Cup driver, Derek Cope. Derek, your thoughts on this thing when you saw it unfold like the rest of us today.
Well, you know, the 43rd running of the Daytona 500, it's certainly the best of times and the worst of times for NASCAR Winston Cup racing. To lose, you know, our most prolific race car driver of NASCAR, it's certainly difficult for all of us to comprehend and fathom at this point in time. But it was a vicious crash and certainly, you know, a difficult one for everyone.
All right, Derek, we're going to take another look at this as it unfolded in the final laps of this race. Certainly to the fan, it may not have looked as if it was that bad of a situation.
Well, obviously right here, you know, coming into turn three and four, Dale Earnhardt was flanked by Ken Schrader on the outside of him and, you know, Sterling Marlin on the inside and had Rusty Wallace right up the, you know, right up his rear, and basically 190 mile an hour impact at that point. The car got loose, it come down on the apron, and it shot immediately back up. You see, he's on the apron, boom, the car's back up. And this type of a crash is so serious from the standpoint that that basically it, right here, you see how the impact is so hard, so vicious, 190 mile an hour. He had no time to react at all, had no time to react whatsoever. It's difficult to watch, difficult to watch.
There's nothing a driver, Derek, can really do at that point with that amount of speed. It doesn't matter how much skill you have or how much control you have over a car. That type of accident, when it happens like that and unfolds like that, there's nothing you can really do as a driver.
Not really. You know, you're at the mercy of whatever happens at that point in time. You know, certainly, you basically get into a situation there where, you know, you're on the last lap of the race. All you're thinking about is trying to keep somebody behind you, protect the lead for your son and for Michael and your teammates. And then basically you get into a situation where somebody taps you, the car goes down, you instantly react. Basically, it was instinctive for Dale Earnhardt. He overcorrected, the car shut off the racetrack. That was the only way it was going to go. There was no way that he or anyone else was going to stop that race car from doing exactly what it did.
And Derek, we spoke earlier today. You said that you had had a similar accident to this, certainly not of this magnitude, but you had hit a wall at a racetrack at a similar amount of speed. Can you tell us a little bit about what it is like as a driver to feel that kind of impact?
Well, certainly the situation that I was in was a bit different from the standpoint that I backed it in and Dale hit it, you know, head on. You go 190 miles an hour off into a corner and you're wide open, and basically when something happens much like this, or a tire blowing in my case, the car gets turned around and you have no way of stopping it, and you're just along for the ride. And certainly Dale, you know Dale, he was battling that thing to the end. He certainly thought he was going to find a way out of it, or he was going to be able to spin around and keep digging. I mean, that's probably what was in his mind right up to the end.
All right, Dale Earnhardt certainly personified toughness in everything that was NASCAR racing. When we continue on this special edition of NASCAR Victory Lane, we'll have more on the Intimidator. Back, everyone, to this special edition of NASCAR Victory Lane. I'm John Roberts, and today the NASCAR world suffered a tragic loss. Dale Earnhardt, the most prolific, toughest driver probably in the history of motorsports, died today in an accident at Daytona. And Derek Cope, probably one of the more ironic things about this whole race today was the fact that earlier in the race, there was an 18-car pileup involving some of the sport's top drivers, which really left people breathless, the way the cars flew around the track. As we take a look at this accident, Derek, can you tell us why this type of accident everybody walked away from, and later on there was such tragedy?
Well, you see an accident like this, and a lot of it is glancing blows and then the actual pirouetting of a car. The actual inertia of the crash is absorbed by, you know, the car dancing and getting on the grass and the other cars just careening off each other. They're built for these types of impacts. And you see the car just makes a turn, slides around, hits, and then gets hit by another car. But the car is not absorbing a lot of really hard, vicious hits. It's rolling around. I'm sure Tony wouldn't thought otherwise, but definitely not of the type of impact that Dale took when his car hit the wall at that point. Because when Dale hit the wall, it's a sudden impact. It's not a glancing blow. It was immediately an instantaneous stop. That is the ones that hurt the drivers the most.
Now, in this situation, the way a car is designed for safety, when the car goes tumbling, Derek, it's designed to take the impact, especially in terms of the roll bar that's inside of the car.
Well, the body itself is just so far it's away from the actual tubing. So what happens is you have a crushing sensation of the sheet metal first. That absorbs a lot of the initial blows. Then you have a lot of the roll bars that protect the actual driver himself, and that absorbs the next impact. So it has several layers of impact resistance to go through before it physically gets to the driver and this feeling that he would get in his body. Again, in contrast to a Dale Earnhardt, a vicious blow like that, basically an instantaneous stop, and obviously the driver's body absorbs that impact.
Now, of course, in a situation of a big pileup, Derek, as a driver, you see all the cars spinning in front of you, you see a lot of smoke, you have a second to prepare. In some of the very tragic accidents we've seen in Winston Cup racing over the past few years, really the question of this thing is, did these drivers have a moment to prepare themselves for that kind of impact?
Well, that's true. I think the key is that when you see it, when something starts happening like that, you basically, all of a sudden, you grab the steering wheel. That's your lifeline. So you really put a death grip on the actual steering wheel. You brace your feet, and then you're looking for some smoke to clear, looking for an avenue to get away. Sometimes in the other instances, you have no time to react. Like Dale, I'm sure at that point, Dale thought again, he was going to find a way out of it. He was going to make the car spin around, probably keep going and drive across the start finish line for a position. That's his mentality, and that's what he thought, I'm sure, up until the blow.
Now back to the 18-car pileup early in the race that was really one of the more horrific-looking wrecks we've seen at Daytona in quite some time. We're going to go inside of Tony Stewart's car. And, Derek, can you just imagine this feeling that Tony Stewart is going through at this time?
Well, again, at this point here, you know you're in trouble. The car turns sideways, and then it gets quiet. That's when you know that you're in trouble, because when the silence comes, you know the car is off the ground. And at that point, you hang on tight, and you just try to, like, sink your head down, and you try to just think about being small. And basically, you just start taking whatever it gives you at that point, and you just hope that it comes down, and you wait for it to stop.
All right, Derek, our special edition of NASCAR Victory Lane will roll on in just a few minutes. Stay with us. There you see the career statistics of Dale Earnhardt, the Intimidator, perhaps one of the toughest guys and one of the toughest personalities ever to drive a Winston Cup car. Well, of course, shock is probably the only way to describe what's going through the NASCAR world today. Dale Earnhardt dead at the age of 49, and Derek Cope, one thing about this guy we will always remember is he accomplished everything you could possibly accomplish in a car. Winston Cup champion, Daytona 500 champion, and perhaps today one of the most amazing things about this guy was he saw what was unfolding in this race and very selflessly backed off and was watching as this whole thing unfolded.
Absolutely, John. That was my sense of what I was seeing. Earlier, a couple of laps prior to that, you could just see that he felt like at his point, you know, that he had Michael Waltrip, his new driver, he had Dale Earnhardt Jr. up there, and he felt like that he'd won his Daytona 500, much as Mike Joy alluded. I felt like that he felt like at that point he was going to let those two guys fight it out, and he was going to do whatever he could do to give them the opportunity to do that. And he was blocking, and he was playing defense for the most of that. That was not the Dale Earnhardt you would see majority of the time. He would be getting to somebody's back bumper, but I think he was really had that sense that he wanted them to win the race.
As the third car back at this time, he was watching as they went to the final lap. He saw his son in front of him, his driver one car in front of him. He had to have quite a feeling of jubilation, and probably as an owner, that was probably as good of a feeling for him to see those two guys in front of him as it was for he himself to win this race.
Well, a man of this magnitude, certainly he's done everything that you could possibly do in this sport. And then to have the self-gratification of seeing your son and your other driver with your race cars running up front, going to win the Daytona 500, absolutely had to be a great feeling for him at that time.
Now, we have to admit, Derek, as we were watching this race, we did say, boy, there's Dale Earnhardt looking in front of him, seeing his driver and his son in front of him. And everybody said, well, you better believe that this guy would do anything he could in his power to win a race, including passing his own guy and his own son. Quite a contrast in Dale Earnhardt we saw today as he actually stood back a little bit instead of charging to the front like the Dale Earnhardt we've all known.
Well, I think that so many times you hear about Dale Earnhardt, the aggressor, the intimidator, heartless. And I think today you saw an individual that really showed a lot of heart to sit back and watch his son and Michael, go to the heights of the sport and win the biggest thing that can happen to you. And he's already experienced that. And I know personally how much it means to be in that position. And I think he was wanting that for one of those two individuals.
All right, Derek, when we come back on this special edition of NASCAR Victory Lane, we're going to try to shift gears just a little bit and touch on some of the great moments of this great racing career, the career of Dale Earnhardt. Thank you. Well, welcome back to this special edition of NASCAR Victory Lane. Of course, today the Daytona 500 claimed the life of seven-time Winston Cup champion Dale Earnhardt. But before tragedy, there was some incredible emotion today, and the emotion of joy as Darrell Waltrip got a chance from the broadcast booth to call one of the happiest moments of his life and of his brother's racing life.
Darrell, we got six laps to go. Take a deep breath and wiggle them toes, man. Take a deep breath and wiggle them toes now.
My poor mama, she's going to be having a fit.
You can help Mikey out here. Come on, buddy. Come on, Mikey. Let's go. You're my man.
Just keep looking in that mirror. Here comes Hamilton. Who's that up on the outside there?
Well, Marlins lost his partners. Here comes Hamilton, 55, towing Rusty Wallace, number two, toward the front.
Oh, man. I didn't have any idea TV was going to be like this. I thought it was going to be a lot of easy work, fun. This is hard work.
Well, it was until about 30 laps ago. Five laps to go.
Leading the Daytona 500 with five laps to go.
Look at Sterling below the apron going into turn one. Ducks back in the line just in time to get there.
Becky run with him. Schrader got kicked back to sixth place.
Let me tell you, that's the best thing that Mikey's got going for him is those two cars behind him. You got to pass two cars to get to him. And those guys are smart enough to know Dale Jr. and Dale Sr., they cannot pull out.
Darrell Waltrip won this race in 89 after 17 years of trying. He and Earnhardt perhaps best know of everyone here the frustration that builds when you've tried so long and so hard to win one Winston Cup race, let alone the biggest of them all.
Junebug getting a little antsy there, but they're getting heat from the back. Sterling's all over Dale Sr. Dale Sr. is trying to keep him back so they can't get to the two team cars in the front. This is a chess match at high speed.
Four laps to go. Single file around lap traffic.
Man, those guys didn't need to be there. They should have got down out of the way.
Michael Waltrip leads that snake down the back straightaway.
I know he's a nervous wreck. Well, maybe he isn't. He's probably as cool as a cucumber. I'm the one who's nervous. Come on, buddy.
He finished fifth in the 599. This is his 15th try.
He thought he was going to win that one, and he just got shuffled out right at the end.
Whoa! Look at Earnhardt. Sterling got into Earnhardt.
Dale is doing everything he can to keep Sterling behind him because Dale knows that Sterling's got a fast car.
Here comes Schrader on the outside, that yellow car. Remember, Schrader's not won in 10 years.
He's got the help there of Bobby Hamilton in the 55. Michael wants to see these guys just all over each other behind him. The more they do that, the more lead way it gives him.
Yeah, they're not going to ever make it up on the outside, I don't believe. They can get a run on him and they can get up there to him, but I don't believe they can pass him.
Every driver dreams of winning the Daytona 500. Michael Waltrip dreams just of winning this race. Any race to break that big 0-for streak, 0 for 462.
I don't know if I can stand this or not. Come on, buddy. You got two to go. Come on, don't give up now.
Outside of three.
Just stay under him, Dale Jr. Just stay under him, buddy.
Two to go, bud. Two to go.
Out of way.
The calm voice of the spotter.
Look at
Chuck
Dale.
Joyce reassuring Michael Waltrip.
Dale has done. Sterling has beat the front end off that old Dodge trying to get around Dale.
Sterling, is there room between Earnhardt and Schrader? Yes, he gets to the outside. Then drops back in line.
All right, here we go now. This is when it's going to get tense, boys.
This is when
we're going to find out. We're coming around for the white flag.
Four Chevys, a Pontiac, a Ford, and a Dodge to fight it out. 3 miles to the finish of the Daytona 500.
If he can survive this run, he'll be okay. Nobody's doing anything. They're all holding.
Go get him.
Come on, buddy. One to go.
The last lap.
One to go, buddy. Keep it low, Mikey. Keep it low. Don't let them under you. Make that back straightaway wide, buddy. Get all over the place. Don't let them run up on you. Come on, man. Come on now. Watch your mirror. Watch it. He's going to make a run inside. Block him. Block him. Atta boy.
Three wide behind them.
You got him, Mikey. You got him, man. You got him. Come on, man.
Come on, baby. Come on.
You
get him in the fold.
Baby. You
get him in the fold.
The three car down.
Oh! Big trouble. Oh. Big wreck
come
behind
on,
them.
Back.
to the flag.
Come on, Mikey. You got it, man.
You got it.
You got it.
You got it.
You got it.
Mikey!
Yes!
All right!
Michael Walsh wins.
All right!
That's a television dream come true.
Right. Oh, man. Woo!
How about that?
All right!
How about Dale? Is he okay?
Schrader has climbed out of his car. He and Earnhardt have crashed together at Liberty Turns 3 and 4.
Look at Buck.
You may have got me on Saturday, but I got you on Sunday.
Daryl, is this better than winning it?
No, it's better than winning it. This is great. I just hope Dale's okay. I guess he's all right, isn't he?
Oh. Michael Waltrip takes off the helmet, drops the window net, and he's about to get the best ride in racing.
Man.
To Daytona 500 Victory Lane.
My daddy would be so happy. Man.
Well, at that time, no one really knew what had transpired, and it is really hard to imagine so much triumph and so much tragedy within just seconds of each other. And Derek, when you think about Michael Waltrip and his career, 462 races without a victory, is it perhaps just another testimonial to Dale Earnhardt's knowledge of racing that he picked Michael Waltrip to drive the third car out of his stable?
Exactly. I think that anytime you look at what, you know, what gotten Dale Earnhardt to where he's at, he knew talent. He obviously had talent, whether he was driving a race car or watching people drive race cars. He knew what it took, and he believed in Michael Waltrip. And I think certainly you look at the equipment it takes these days to run up front and be in a position to win races, and Dale Earnhardt has amassed a great, great group of individuals there at DEI that are capable of winning week in and week out.
All right, Derek, we will be back in just a moment on this special edition of NASCAR Victory Lane, back with more from Dale Earnhardt. Well, there you see it, the life of a true champion, Dale Earnhardt. He is dead tonight at the age of 49. Certainly a very difficult night for anyone involved in NASCAR. And earlier tonight, in case you missed it, NASCAR President Mike Helton had to make the kind of announcement that everyone dreads making.
There's no question this is a very difficult time. I think Bill France's quote that the Speedway and NASCAR will put out here in a second sums it up for the moment. There'll be other press conferences and other opportunities to answer questions as we get more answers. But his quote is that NASCAR has lost its greatest driver ever. And I personally have lost a great friend. And that's Bill France's quote. And I think that pretty well sums it up for the NASCAR community right now.
All right, NASCAR has certainly lost one of the greatest competitors of all time. Now, there are a ton of questions, but the bottom line is right now that Dale Earnhardt is dead at the age of 49. And Dr. Steve Bohannon tried to explain some of the particulars that went on from the medical side of this tragic accident.
He was not breathing and had no palpable pulse from the time of the first paramedic's arrival at the scene and remained that way throughout. That's all I have.
All right, certainly a very difficult time. And Derek, they often talk about NASCAR as a family, as a community. At this point, you know, there's nothing more you can do but pack up the haulers and go home and try to make it business as usual. But, boy, how can anybody do that right now?
It's extremely difficult. I think that certainly everybody's leaving Daytona with heavy hearts on a day that you should be leaving with, you know, a lot of joy in your heart. And everybody has to come back to Charlotte in total dismay, and it's a difficult time. And for all the fans worldwide, you know, who have followed Dale through the years, certainly have heavy hearts at this point. So it's a difficult time for all of us. And you know, you just don't, you know, you wonder how you can get ready to go to Rockingham. You know, we've had so many things happen as of late, but you know that these guys will forge ahead.
Now, I know, Derek, we here certainly cannot speak for NASCAR or any other drivers, but is there a time when you actually consider not running the next race because of a tragedy of this magnitude?
At this point, I would not want to be the person to set anything in that regard. I don't believe that you'll see that. I think that the guys will be at Rockingham ready to go do their jobs, and that's probably what Dale would probably have wanted.
Yeah, there's no question about that. If Dale Earnhardt were here tonight, he probably would tell us the exact same thing. Stay with us. We'll have more of this special edition of NASCAR Victory Lane. Edition of NASCAR Victory Lane as we try to sort out the details of the tragic death of world-class champion Dale Earnhardt, seven-time Winston Cup champion, and truly the intimidator. Derek Cope, a guy like Dale Earnhardt in the traveling world that is NASCAR racing, anybody that's come in contact with this guy certainly has some fantastic memories of him and his career.
Well, Dale Earnhardt leaves a lasting impression on you. Certainly the first time that I ever saw the man race was a long time ago. His rookie year, 1979, I was carrying tires at Ontario Motor Speedway where he clinched the Rookie of the Year title. And then the first time I ever met him was at Riverside, California. Through the years, obviously, Dale's not a man of a lot of words when you don't know him personally. And I don't claim to know Dale on a personal level to the extent that, you know, Michael or someone like that would. But, you know, Dale, he had his way of saying something to you, coming up to you, hitting you or doing something, nudging you, you know, as yeah. His typical intimidator way, you know, in his demeanor of trying to say, hey, how you doing, you know, kind of thing. And, you know, some of the fondest memories, though, you know, was really a sense of when I won Daytona. And certainly I knew how devastating that moment was for him. You know, it was really my first full year, really, in Winston Cup racing to that extent. And I almost felt bad about winning it from the standpoint that, you know, he had led the thing so dominantly all day long, you know, and then something to happen. And, you know, he came up to me at Rockingham and said something, you know, and congratulated me. So that meant a lot.
All right. And any guy that has come into contact with Dale Earnhardt certainly has meant a lot to them. We'll be back with more of this special edition of NASCAR Victory Lane. Stay with us. Special edition of NASCAR Victory Lane. Derek Cope, with a little bit of time we have left, can you give us your final thoughts on today's death of Dale Earnhardt?
NASCAR will go on, John, but we truly have lost the most dynamic individual this sport's ever known, I think, and certainly will never be forgotten.
All right, let's take a look now back at the incredible career that was Dale Earnhardt. Dale Earnhardt was born to stock car racing in Kannapolis, North Carolina in 1951. His father, Ralph, was the 1956 NASCAR Sportsman Division champion and a popular man in the Winston Cup garage. The Earnhardts forged their relationship working underneath Ralph's race car. Ralph died in 1973 while working on that car. For Dale, his father's sport wasn't just a way of life, it was life. When Earnhardt took to the racetracks of North Carolina's Piedmont region, his natural talent was obvious but unrefined. And when he arrived on the Winston Cup circuit full-time in 1979, he reveled in his ability to ruffle the feathers of the established superstars. Earnhardt took a sport that was accustomed to the king and introduced it to the intimidator. Driving for car owner Rod Osterlin in 1980, Earnhardt became the first driver to win Rookie of the Year and the Winston Cup Championship in back-to-back seasons. After a stint with legendary owner Bud Moore, Earnhardt signed on with former independent driver Richard Childress. In 1984 and 85, the relationship created more wrecks than wins, but a dynasty was in the making. From 1986 to 1994, Earnhardt and Childress won 6 Winston Cup titles and 48 races. They won on short tracks, they won on speedways, and the Flying Aces were the best pit crew in the history of the sport. Their way was rough and tumble, hands dirty racing. It left competitors mad, fans thrilled, and it made them rich. The man in black developed a fan following that the sport had never seen. He copyrighted his signature and his name, earning more in annual souvenir sales than the rest of the garage combined. His career spanned 4 decades, taking on the best of each racing generation: Petty, Pearson, Yarborough, Wallace, Elliott, and Gordon, and he beat them all. But Earnhardt's Achilles heel was always Daytona. He had won at the legendary racetrack more than any driver in history, but never in the Daytona 500. In 1998, on the 20th try, and on NASCAR's 50th anniversary, the sport's biggest star finally took the sport's biggest prize. Earnhardt had discovered a renewed spirit over the last season and a half. Injuries and distractions had affected the Intimidator's winning ways. After Daytona, he didn't win for nearly two seasons. But the arrival of his son, Dale Earnhardt Jr., seemed to breathe new life into the old man's career. He won three races in 1999, two in 2000, and found success as a car owner with his son and former modified driver, Steve Park. And ironically today, with the victory of Michael Waltrip in the Daytona 500. This season, he had already spoken of his record-breaking eighth title, laughing off talk of age, and coming to Daytona in the best health of his life. 2 weeks ago, he and Junior placed third in the prestigious 24 Hours of Daytona, their first ever sports car race. On Friday, his amazing save in the International Race of Champions, along with his classic Earnhardt retaliation, had fans on their feet once again. But on Sunday, within sight of a place he had visited more than any other man, the finish line at Daytona, those fans were silenced. Dale Earnhardt was 49 years old.
After the accident in turn four at the end of the Daytona 500, we've lost Dale Earnhardt. Our prayers and wishes and our effort right now, this moment, is with Teresa and the Earnhardt family. NASCAR has lost its greatest driver ever.
We should be celebrating the first victory of Michael Waltrip's Winston Cup racing career. Instead, NASCAR says goodbye to the man who was indeed the sport.
The entire world of racing is stunned right now as NASCAR not only loses the best driver of this era, but quite possibly the best driver in history of NASCAR racing.
He was just a half mile from the finish in the final turn and the final lap of NASCAR's biggest race of the season. And for some reason, Dale Earnhardt was taken from us. The seven-time Winston Cup champion and 1998 Daytona 500 winner died Sunday from severe head injuries suffered during the crash. Earnhardt was just trying to protect the lead for the two cars that he owns, those of Michael Waltrip and Dale Earnhardt Jr., his son, when he apparently got clipped by Sterling Marlin. Earnhardt crashed into the wall after being hit by Kenny Schrader. When paramedics arrived, Earnhardt was unconscious. They had to cut him from the car, which took 5 to 10 minutes. Now, Dr. Steve Bohannon said another physician was performing CPR when he arrived, but that Dale Earnhardt died instantly from severe head injuries, saying, quote, "There was nothing that could be done for him." 27 drivers have died at this speedway since it opened in 1959. Dale Earnhardt Jr., who finished second, rushed to the infield to be with his father, who received the best medical attention on the spot. He was later transported to Halifax Medical Center, but efforts to revive him were unsuccessful.
Well, there may be no parallel to this tragic moment in the history of sports. Earnhardt was more than just a living legend. At the age of 49, he was still racing's most popular driver and considered a favorite to win his record eighth championship this year. Instead, he tragically left us in the final moments of NASCAR's premier event. To attempt to put this terrible loss in perspective, we now send it to Chris Myers and our crew in Daytona.
Seven-time Winston Cup champion and former Daytona 500 winner Dale Earnhardt has died from a crash suffered in Sunday's Daytona 500. The accident occurred on the final lap of Sunday's race. The tragic news came Sunday night, 2 hours after the race ended, from NASCAR President Mike Helton.
This is undoubtedly one of the toughest announcements that I've ever personally had to make. But after the accident in turn four at the end of the Daytona 500, we've lost Dale Earnhardt. And I have with me Dr. Steve Bohannon, who's a trauma doctor here in Daytona that's worked several events here at the Speedway, and he can explain the medical practice that went on at the accident scene and over to the hospital. In a timing issue, we're here to tell you what we know. We don't know a lot. We don't know enough to answer all your questions. Our prayers and wishes and our effort right now, this moment, is with Teresa and the Earnhardt family. Richard Childress and his family, and Dale Earnhardt Incorporated. But I'll have Dr. Bohannon take it from here for right now.
I was on one of the ambulances that responded to the accident. I was about the third or fourth ambulance in. When I arrived, there were a number of paramedics already attending to him. There was a paramedic in through the passenger window, applying oxygen by a mask. Dr. Tim Allison, who's a trauma surgeon from Flagler County, was in through the driver's window and was delivering CPR. And there was another paramedic in the window with him, helping maintain the C-spine, holding the head. There were a number of firefighters that were on top of the car attempting to remove the roof, which was subsequently done. That took about 5 or 10 minutes, during which time we did CPR. When the roof came off, Dr. Allison and I both identified this was a very bad situation, a load and go situation. We immediately removed him and transported him to the area level 2 trauma center, Halifax Hospital. Transport time was about a minute to a minute and a half, during which time we continued CPR. There was a full trauma team there to meet him, a trauma neurosurgeon, Dr. Bill Kuhn, trauma surgeon, Dr. Demiuga. There were several emergency room doctors there as well. We all did everything we could for him. And additionally, there was an anesthesiologist who helped us maintain the airway. But he had what I feel were life-ending type injuries at the time of impact, and really nothing could be done for him.
Dale Earnhardt would have been 50 in April. The man who was NASCAR racing with 76 Winston Cup victories is survived by his wife, Teresa, 4 children, Carrie, Kelly King, Taylor Nicole, and Dale Earnhardt Jr., who finished second in Sunday's Daytona 500 behind Michael Waltrip, both cars owned by Dale Earnhardt. I'm joined now by Mike Joy, who called Sunday's Daytona 500 on Fox.
Well, Chris, the pre-race was a very relaxing time for Dale Earnhardt. He was relaxing in his interviews and chose to spend that time in the morning with family and with friends, laughing, joking, cajoling the folks that he'd go out and race against in today's Daytona 500. New hire Michael Waltrip, wife Teresa, son Dale Jr. Michael Waltrip and his son. Two cars touch. Earnhardt's number 3 and Ken Schrader launch to the fourth turn wall. Schrader climbed from the wreckage, walked over to Earnhardt's car, and called for paramedics. The race had ended. Waltrip had won. Earnhardt Jr. ran not to victory lane, but toward his father's car. Followed the ambulance to Halifax Medical Center.
Joining Mike Joy is Jeff Hammond and Ken Squire. Jeff Hammond, of course, former crew chief. You worked with Dale Earnhardt and competed against him many times.
Yeah, Chris, it's really kind of hard to say. I mean, I was fortunate enough to watch Dale get in his first car way back when we were racing at Concord, and his daddy was still helping Dale. And a competitor, I don't think I know of anybody I've ever been around. It epitomizes the word. The man was relentless as far as his competition was concerned. We had a lot of good times together. We raced together on those dirt tracks at home. We used to go to his place and ride in the back of his boat, go tubing together. We've done some hunting together, but through all our relationship and friendship, he always was a competitor.
And did a lot for his sport. 27 years in Winston Cup racing. As you look at all of the accomplishments of Dale Earnhardt, former Rookie of the Year, and of course won Daytona 500 after after so many years of trying to. Back in 1998, it finally happened. Mike Joy, you called most of the races through his entire career, nicknamed the Intimidator, but it was hard not to like him if you met him.
You had to respect him. You had to like him. The compass of this sport has lost its true north. Dale Earnhardt defined the limits of on-track behavior, and every time he pushed that limit, the limit moved with him. But more importantly, Chris, he set the standard and the goals for every driver who followed him.
And Ken Squire, you saw all of his Daytona 500 performances. This was his 23rd consecutive start, and it's difficult to describe or put into words what Dale Earnhardt did for NASCAR racing.
Well, whatever stock car racing is, Dale Earnhardt was. He was the child in the back of a pickup truck at the Charlotte Motor Speedway with his dad, watching those cars in the 600 and dreaming someday of being in Winston Cup racing. He was the teenager whose equipment was a t-shirt and a crash helmet, bumming rides, building cars, trying to prove that he could handle those short tracks in the Carolinas just as well as his father, Ralph Earnhardt, did, who was a national champion. He was the guy that came along in 1979 and became Rookie of the Year in Winston Cup racing, and 1 year later was the Winston Cup national champion. And through it all, he seemed quiet. He became the Intimidator, one who didn't have much to say, but who did it with his deeds on the racetrack. His wife, Teresa, changed a lot of that. He became much easier with the media. Until 1994, on this very track, just a few hundred feet from where he died today, his best friend in this world, Neil Bonnett, lost his life in a very similar type of crash. It seemed as if he went into a dark period for a bit. And then he's come out of it. 1997, nearly won the 500. It was right there. And then was upside down in the backstretch, refused to go to the medical center, got back in and drove the car around and finished the race. And then 1 year later, we saw him in victory lane. 20 years of effort in winning the race that meant the most to him, and there he was, up on top of the world. He told me in victory lane that day, yes, yes, 20 years. Can you believe it? Now we come to this point in his career. Going down the backstretch in the final lap, out in front, Michael Waltrip in one of his cars. His son is running in second place. And two of his colleagues, two of his racing pals, are right in there beside him going for a photo finish for third spot. There's Ken Schrader from Missouri on the outside. There's Sterling Marlin from Tennessee on the inside. And as they went into that turn and he saw what was coming about, I would consider that Dale Earnhardt died happy.
The irony of this, Mike Joy, is just that. Gave a chance to Michael Waltrip, who hadn't won in 462 races. His son finishing second, both cars owned by Dale Earnhardt, and competing to the very, very end.
Earnhardt had won this race. He knew the great joy of winning the 500. And Larry McReynolds, Darrell Waltrip, and I, calling those final laps, somehow knew that he would protect the lead of Waltrip and his son, let them fight it out among themselves, and may the best man win. And that's what he was doing when he and Sterling Marlin touched and Earnhardt went caroming off to the wall. It is such irony that the man who celebrates as the Daytona 500 champion can't have his car owner and benefactor share in that celebration.
I spoke with Dale Earnhardt this week. He said that after the neck surgery a couple of years ago, seeking that eighth Winston Cup title was very important to him, and he felt like he could drive for another 10 years or so. Unfortunately, that dream has been cut short. Dale Earnhardt, who would have turned 50 years old in April, has died on the final lap in the 43rd running of the Daytona 500.
Of course, we have much more to talk about in the wake of this tragic loss.
And when we come back, we'll hear from Matt Morrison, who was on the scene as it happened.
NASCAR fans mourning the death of the Intimidator, Dale Earnhardt. A memorial is on display outside of Dale Earnhardt Incorporated in Kannapolis, North Carolina. Once again, at the end of NASCAR's biggest race, the sport suffered its greatest loss. Dale Earnhardt died on the final turn of the final lap of Sunday's Daytona 500.
It is a sudden and unthinkable death for the Intimidator, who was expected to have one of the best years ever and seemed ready to fulfill those expectations when he joined our Chris Myers and Jeff Hammond earlier this week.
You seem like you're so relaxed and so confident right now coming into this week. I mean, just...
I am. I feel good about this. And you've never noticed because you've always been working on race cars. Right. But I feel this way pretty much every year until I don't win the Daytona 500. And it's a bad time. But, you know, Victory Lane's where you want to be. And it took me 20 years to get there. But I do feel good. I feel better this time than I did last year, really. I feel more relaxed. And maybe it's because I've had such a great time the whole 24 hours and this week leading up to the Daytona 500, the whole thing.
After the surgery, you could drive for another 10 years. What's your plan?
Yeah, it put 10 years on my career, really. I'm in good shape, and the race cars are handling great, but I did get the surgery straightened out with my neck, and I had a great year last year, so I'm even stronger this year. I'm working out and staying in shape, so I'm focused. I'm determined. I'm going to go out here and give it our all this year.
NASCAR's week of celebration at Daytona ended abruptly when Dale Earnhardt slammed into the wall on the final lap. Fox Sports Net's Matt Morrison was on the infield when the crash happened. He was also at the hospital when the news of Earnhardt's death was released. He now joins us from Halifax Medical Center. Matt?
Thank you, Steve. As you can imagine, there were some very anxious hours here in Daytona Beach this evening as news of Dale Earnhardt's condition was only rumored for several hours. Then, of course, the terrible confirmation by NASCAR President Mike Helton came in the infield at 7:30. Many NASCAR fans gathered here at Halifax Medical Center in order to pay their respects. And although it is the furthest thing from anybody's mind right now, the question is, how quickly do they go back to racing? And we asked veteran race analyst Ned Jarrett, should the circuit be continued next week at Rockingham?
Yes, I think they should. And Dale Earnhardt would want them to go back to Rockingham next week because, you know, this is the business and the form of life that they chose. And the world doesn't stop when we lose somebody, even as great as Dale Earnhardt was. The world doesn't stop, and he wouldn't want it to stop. He would want the sport to go on. He would want his son to be there next week racing. Now, I don't know if that'll happen or not, but I'll guarantee you that's what he would have wanted.
And we did speak with NASCAR official this evening, and there is no official word on next week's scheduled race at Rockingham, but the precedent has been set. Last year, of course, the circuit lost two drivers, Adam Petty and Kenny Irwin, at the racetrack at New Hampshire, and in both instances, the races the weekend afterwards did continue. Steve, that's the story from Daytona Beach Sunday evening.
All right, Matt, thank you very much.
Well, Dale Earnhardt was one of the biggest critics of last year's Daytona 500, which ran with a minimum number of lead changes and excitement for the fans. And he was one of the major proponents of the aerodynamic rules changes that led to the return of tight, bumper-to-bumper racing at this year's 500. And he knew this was pretty much inevitable. 26 laps to go, Robbie Gordon bumps Ward Burton, and then everyone gets involved, including the 20-car Tony Stewart, who flips over several times. 19 cars involved in this crash, including the likes of two-time Daytona 500 champion Jeff Gordon, last year's winner Dale Jarrett, Mark Martin, Jeff Burton, last year's Winston Cup points champion Bobby Labonte as well. You can see his car is on fire there. As for Stewart, miraculously, just a sore shoulder, he was okay. Final lap, Michael Waltrip holding off his teammate Dale Earnhardt Jr. As you can see, in the final turn, Dale Earnhardt goes into the wall. However, Michael Waltrip, who started 19th, takes home the checkered flag. His brother, Darrell, working for Fox, obviously excited, as is his wife, Buffy. Michael Waltrip, a winner. It took 15 years and 463 career Winston Cup starts, but Waltrip finally gets to the winner's circle. He's the sixth driver to pocket the Daytona 500 as his first career win. Now, before Michael Waltrip knew the death of his race car owner and friend, Dale Earnhardt, he said, "The only reason I was in this race is Dale Earnhardt."
Still ahead, we're going to get some perspective on what the Daytona 500 meant to Dale Earnhardt as we revisit his lone Daytona victory.
Trying 20 years of frustration. Dale Earnhardt will come to the caution flag to win the Daytona 500. Finally, the most anticipated moment in racing. If John Elway can win the Super Bowl, Dale Earnhardt said he could win the Daytona 500.
In 1998, his 20th NASCAR season, Dale Earnhardt got the one victory that he wanted most of all, the Daytona 500. It was a time of tremendous joy for the man who was considered the sport's best super speedway driver. I was able to share a few moments with him in the days following that win.
First question is, you look at Jimmy Leland, it took him 30 years to win a world championship. John Elway, four tries at the Super Bowl. Did you go into this Daytona 500 thinking that maybe this was your year after 19 tries?
Steve, you feel like it is, or you feel good about it every year you go into Daytona, but it seemed like there was something about this year that was special. Everybody before you got down there testing and working through all everything you do through the winter, this is your year. This is going to be your year to win a Daytona 500. It was just a feeling about it, and the car ran great. And Thursday, in the qualifying race, went out and won it. It was a brand new race car, and we'll go out and win the Daytona 500.
Well, I know a lot of the guys were saying, hey, if I can't win it, we'd love to see Dale win it. And your sport is famous for some altercations, guys throwing helmets at each other, and yet when you win it, I mean, all the pit rolls, they came and gave you the high fives. Like you said, that must have been the most incredible moment, maybe bigger than the race itself.
It was big, And Saturday afternoon, we had a problem with an engine, and we was going to have to change engines, and we'd practiced a little bit with the engine we had in it, but it just wasn't up to par. And I was a little bit concerned at that point, and I was focused on that. We finished practice, and out of the car, and they were pushing the car back to the garage area, and I walked into the NASCAR garage office, and they had five Make-A-Wish kids that wanted to see Earnhardt, and they had it set up, and I walked in there. And I was a little down in the dumps, worried about the engine, you know, and we'd ran so good all week. And here's these five Make-A-Wish kids, and I started signing autographs, started talking to them, and they sort of pumped me up. And then this one little five-year-old girl, Wisa, and she was in a wheelchair, and she was just smiling from ear to ear, had a big Dale Earnhardt 3 t-shirt on. And here she is, you know, she's been dealt all kind of stuff in her life, and she's smiling and excited about seeing me. And she had a penny, and she said, here's your lucky penny. You're going to win the Daytona 500. We got pictures with her and done all this stuff. I came out of there feeling great, you know. And I went over to the car, and we talked about the engine change and all, and I took some glue, some 3M glue, and glued on the penny and stuck it to the dashboard. Carried the penny the whole race. We won the race. Now my lucky penny's in the
museum. It's still in the car, isn't it?
Still in the car.
Earnhardt had more than twice as many wins as any other driver at Daytona. In fact, that was the first time that he was shut out during Speed Week at the track since 1989. The 2.5-mile oval belonged to him more than any other driver.
When we return, we'll have more on the passing of a legend. Plus, we'll take a look at the dangers that NASCAR drivers face every time they step in a car.
The National Sports Report is brought to
you. Understand, how can these men, who are husbands and fathers and sons, climb into these machines knowing their lives are on the line each and every weekend? I guess crashes are a part of NASCAR racing. Part that turns this from popular sport to somber scene. Dale Earnhardt was indeed one of a kind. Now he's one of the men who died doing what he loved.
Gordon Fireball Roberts, as popular in the 60s as Earnhardt was in the 90s. Roberts was the most famous driver on the circuit when his car caught on fire in Charlotte in May of 1964. Sadly, 1964 saw two tragedies on the track. Star driver Joe Weatherly rammed into a wall in Riverside, California earlier that year. He died when his head hit the concrete barrier outside of his car. That death led to the safety net on the driver's door, still in use today. It would be a quarter century until NASCAR buried another driver. Tim Richmond, one of racing's best young drivers, died of AIDS in 1989. 4 years later, the sport lost two of its brightest. Alan Kulwicki, a renegade, rebellious driver who reminded some of a young intimidator, died in an airplane crash in April of 1993 outside of Bristol, Tennessee, a year after he won the Winston Cup points race. One of the many beat out for that championship was Davey Allison, who would have won the title outright had he not crashed on the last lap of the year's final race. Allison, a member of one of racing's most famous families and on the cusp of greatness, died 3 months after Colwicky in a helicopter crash on the infield of the Talladega Super Speedway. Less than a year later, Daytona would be the scene of a terrifying accident. Neil Bonnet crashed into the outside wall on turn 4 of the speedway during a practice run. Bonnet was one of Dale Earnhardt's closest friends. Their deaths occurred 7 years apart and less than 100 yards from each other. No family had more generations involved in racing than the Pettys. The youngest of that generation, Adam Petty, lost his life in May of last year at the New Hampshire International Speedway, only months after he mourned the loss of his great-grandfather Lee, one of NASCAR's true pioneers. It was another tragic twist of fate when Kenny Irwin died coming around the same turn on the same track later that year.
The death of Dale Earnhardt at the Daytona 500 was the fourth fatal accident that NASCAR has seen in less than a year. Last season, Adam Petty, Kenny Irwin, and Tony Roper all died of the same type of head injuries that took Earnhardt's life on Sunday. For more on this terrible tragedy, we now send it out to NASCAR Victory Lane's John Roberts, who's standing by in Charlotte. John?
Steve, thanks a lot. It's really hard to imagine the kind of range of emotions that NASCAR fans had to feel today. First, it was the victory of Michael Waltrip, and then it was the tragic death, one of the most popular drivers, one of the best drivers of all time, Dale Earnhardt. Now, Derek Cope is a veteran Winston Cup driver. Derek, can you make a little bit of sense out of this whole thing, why it transpired?
Well, John, seemingly Dale Earnhardt was playing defense. He has won the Daytona 500, and I think that he was looking for the opportunity for his son, Dale Jr., or Michael Waltrip, his new driver, to bask in that same glory, and he was going to give him that opportunity selflessly. And that led to the opportunity for him to be with two other competitors on the outside of him and to have the vicious crash that we see that basically gets tapped by Sterling Marlin, hits the bottom of the banking, and then viciously crashes at 190 miles an hour into the wall side retaining wall and then slides down the banking to a stop.
Now, perhaps that one didn't look quite as serious as it really was to the fan. In fact, when they went back up to the booth, Dale Waltrip said, I hope Dale's all right. It looks like he is. That definitely was not the case. And to make this thing really a little bit more worse, as you go inside the car there, Derek, the impact, really, it's hard to judge from our point of view.
When you see it on TV, it doesn't look that vicious, but from inside the race car in the video you just saw, you can tell that the impact is of magnitude. It's one that is an instantaneous stop. The driver basically, everything inside the race car is trying to leave, and those are the ones that hurt the drivers the most. We've seen it happen countless times in the past year, so unlike the other 18-car wreck.
All right, now when you mention that 18-car wreck, perhaps that's another thing that makes this accident so much more incredible. Here you got cars flying all over the racetrack. Derek, everybody walks out of this one pretty much unscathed.
Well, yeah, this is a typical racetrack where you basically have a lot of cars crashing each other. You would think that by looks of this, that this is, horrific, basically. But the race cars themselves, they absorb a great deal of the impact and the inertia when they're rolling around and spiraling in the air. They're hitting the grass and they're upside down. But they're just tumbling, so they're not really taking that vicious, instantaneous stop that really is what hurts these drivers. These guys all walk away, and you would not know that from watching this if you're just an average individual, but these guys here all walk away with just minor bruises.
Now, Derek, you've been in the car before in a situation like this. How does a driver prepare, first of all, for a wreck like that when you see it coming, but then on the flip side of the whole thing, a wreck like Dale Earnhardt's today, you just don't have time to prepare.
Well, in the 18-car crash, you basically have time. All you see is smoke, the spotter saying slow down, go low, go high, and you have time to really put a grip on the steering wheel and brace yourself for the impact, and then you kind of know what's going on. You have time to react, and you just kind of sink yourself down and make yourself real small. In contrast, and when you see Dale Earnhardt, when a situation like that, it's instantaneous. Dale was still fighting the race car. He got down on the apron. He overcorrected the char, shoots up the racetrack, and hits the wall instantaneously, stopping every motion that the car has. Those are the impacts that really hurt you.
All right, now Dale Earnhardt was a guy who had an impact on everyone he met. Derek Cope, how are you going to remember Dale Earnhardt, the Intimidator, best?
He's absolutely the most dominant force in this business, and he'll be remembered forever. I mean, this sport will not be the same without Dale Earnhardt.
All right, Derek, no question about that. Steve, a lot of heavy hearts around this part of the country, and I think worldwide, as everybody mourns the death of a true champion, Dale Earnhardt. Back to you.
No question about that. Thank you very much, John.
You know, Steve, we've all kind of walked around today, just kind of in this daze after what happened, and we didn't even know the man. And reaction is starting to pour in from other drivers. John Andretti said, "I feel like somebody kicked me in the chest. I'm stunned. I'm sad, and that's about all I have to say." Well, we will certainly continue with more coverage on the passing of Dale Earnhardt. He was respected by simply everybody in the sport, and when we continue, we hear from the men that he competed against. Dale Earnhardt was nicknamed the Intimidator. If there was a race out there, he wanted to win it any way he could.
And late last year, we caught up with several of Earnhardt's competitors and co-workers. They helped paint the picture that was the man in black.
Dale undoubtedly is the best I've ever seen out on a racetrack, and I've been in this business for 30-some years. There's been years the team's let him down. You know, we've had cars that just weren't quite up to date or up to speed or whatever you want to say. We got a little behind a couple of years. But when he's out there, he's giving it 100%.
Dale may possibly be the best driver there's ever been in racing.
Dale Earnhardt is the most intense, driven race car driver I've ever raced against. He is just right down to the line of ruthless on the racetrack. You know, he is intense, and he's probably the toughest I've ever raced against.
He gives a persona and an image of being a mean, tough guy. He's not. He's a nice guy that happens to be very aggressive on the racetrack. Now, if you don't think that he'll knock you out of the way to win a race, you got another thing coming, because he'll do whatever it takes to win a race.
He is also a very, very, very different person than a lot of people know. And, you know, if you can ever get him outside of that element, he is kind, thoughtful, cool guy.
He's been a great race car driver. He's made other drivers better because he is so good. And off the track, I mean, he's done, you know, he's willing to take time when he could be spending time with his family or doing the things that he likes to do. He's taking time out of his life to help promote the sport. And I benefited from that, and everybody that has come after Dale Earnhardt has benefited from that.
Well, as you heard, the mention of his name struck fear in the other drivers. Dale Earnhardt. His look was intimidating, but not nearly as much as his attitude. The man in black turned Daytona into Dale-tona. He won a record 34 races there. But on this Sunday, Dale Earnhardt lost his life. John Roberts has more on number three, NASCAR's number one man.
Dale Earnhardt was born to stock car racing in Kannapolis, North Carolina in 1951. His father, Ralph, was the 1956 NASCAR Sportsman Division champion and a popular man in the Winston Cup garage. The Earnhardts forged their relationship working underneath Ralph's race car. Ralph died in 1973 while working on that car. For Dale, his father's sport wasn't just a way of life, it was life. When Earnhardt took to the racetracks of North Carolina's Piedmont region, his natural talent was obvious but unrefined. And when he arrived on the Winston Cup circuit full-time in 1979, he reveled in his ability to ruffle the feathers of the established superstars. Earnhardt took a sport that was accustomed to the king and introduced it to the Intimidator. Driving for car owner Rod Osterlin in 1980, Earnhardt became the first driver to win Rookie of the Year and the Winston Cup Championship in back-to-back seasons. After a stint with legendary owner Bud Moore, Earnhardt signed on with former independent driver Richard Childress. In 1984 and 85, the relationship created more wrecks than wins, but a dynasty was in the making. From 1986 to 1994, Earnhardt and Childress won 6 Winston Cup titles and 48 races. They won on short tracks, they won on speedways, and the Flying Aces were the best pit crew in the history of the sport. Their way was rough and tumble, hands dirty racing. It left competitors mad, fans thrilled, and it made them rich. The man in black developed a fan following that the sport had never seen. He copyrighted his signature and his name, earning more in annual souvenir sales than the rest of the garage combined. His career spanned 4 decades, taking on the best of each racing generation: Petty, Pearson, Yarborough, Wallace, Elliott, and Gordon, and he beat them all. But Earnhardt's Achilles heel was always Daytona. He had won at the legendary racetrack more than any driver in history, but never in the Daytona 500. In 1998, on the 20th try, and on NASCAR's 50th anniversary, the sport's biggest star finally took the sport's biggest prize. Earnhardt had discovered a renewed spirit over the last season and a half. Injuries and distractions had affected the Intimidator's winning ways. After Daytona, he didn't win for nearly two seasons. But the arrival of his son, Dale Earnhardt Jr., seemed to breathe new life into the old man's career. He won three races in 1999, two in 2000, and found success as a car owner with his son and former modified driver, Steve Park. And ironically, today, with the victory of Michael Waltrip in the Daytona 500. This season, he had already spoken of his record-breaking eighth title, laughing off talk of age and coming to Daytona in the best health of his life. 2 weeks ago, he and Junior placed third in the prestigious 24 Hours of Daytona, their first ever sports car race. But on Sunday, within sight of a place he had visited more than any other man, the finish line at Daytona, those fans were silenced. Dale Earnhardt was 49 years old.
Some people have a passion for driving. One such person is engineer Chris Marr.
Obviously, we've been focusing on the passing of Dale Earnhardt, but there were some other sports as well on Sunday.
Yes, there were plenty of pro hoops, and we'll go to that right now with the Suns and Six.
We want to take another phone call, Johnny. Melissa from Washington. Go ahead, Melissa.
Hi. I'd just like to say that our thoughts and prayers are with the Earnhardt family, and I think it would be nice if they could maybe do some type of memorial lap next week at The Rock and then retire the number three.
I have to think that's probably, maybe I'm not, the retirement is probably in the works, but I think at Rockingham it's going to be all about Dale Earnhardt.
Most definitely. And I would not be surprised to see the number three retired from Winston Cup Racing. We've talked about Dale Jr. His oldest son, Kerry Earnhardt, is a racer too. He had four children, Kelly and Taylor, the other two children. He was quite a family man. We didn't see that an awful lot. In recent years, we've seen he and Teresa and Taylor together, and of course with Dale Jr. now on the circuit. But Dale Earnhardt was quite a family man and a wonderful father.
With the nickname The Intimidator, the family sometimes doesn't get brought up. People are intimidated by that. Johnny, thank you.
Sure thing.
We're going to take a quick break. Much more to come when we come back. Don't go away.
Day, he stayed at the track until almost midnight and talked to every single reporter who requested an interview. He savored that moment the way NASCAR fans will savor his legacy. Mike Gleason has a look back.
Earnhardt finally is a champion of the Daytona 500.
The Intimidator.
That he'd take him here today, and you know, it's very ironic that there his race cars were in front of him and going on and finishing first and second in the Daytona 500, and there he was a quarter of a mile from the finish and didn't quite get there.
On the last day of his life, he was vintage Dale Earnhardt, 49 years old. In his 23rd Daytona 500, he was his intimidating best. Earnhardt bumped Sterling Marlin off the lead early in the race, traded paint with rookie Ron Hornaday a few laps later, then gunning past another rookie, Kurt Busch. Earnhardt flashed him an obscene gesture. On one of his other passes, he drove onto the edge of the grass. In tonight's Sunday Conversation, it is a collection of Dale.
I can remember going to the races with my dad when I was 10, 12 years old, and that was what you was involved in. I really didn't play that much sports in school. I was always eager to get home and see what was going on with the shop, the race car, and couldn't wait to go to the next race. I'm a race car driver, and I've stayed competitive, and I started racing. My first thing in racing when I got in a race car was to want to race. I get psyched up for the 500. It's the first race of the year. We've tested, we've worked hard. I'm ready to go. I'm ready to go racing. I'm down in the garage area bouncing around, seeing everything, what's going on, and the guys are all pumped up. I'm ready to go racing. It's not going to break my heart if I win eight championships and never won the Daytona 500.
50th anniversary of NASCAR. Who would have believed I could win the Daytona 500 and 50th anniversary of Daytona? Our 20th year here, we're going to win that championship. Anything you can have or do to to be competitive more than the other guy and beat him is a part of your plan to beat them or your system to beat them. And if you can intimidate them and then they call you the intimidator, well, so be it.
Who or what intimidates Dale Earnhardt?
My wife. Don't you think a kid that's raced in Winston Cup, Bushman National Long, would know what to wear a sponsor's hat? Like, you know, Dad does. Dad?
I'm still learning.
His big brother carries first race, and he's got a sponsor's hat on.
Slow learning.
Well, you was quick on the track yesterday, but you need to please wear the sponsor's hat.
You do look around and try to not go so fast. You need to stop and say hi or say, you know, call your mom and tell you love her before you leave town or when you get back in town. And I still don't do that enough. You know, be close with your wife and kids and stuff like that. Because I'm going to tell you, I'm a lucky person. I've got a great wife, got a great family, got great kids. Fortunate to have a lot of things and to be able to enjoy a lot of things. Probably a lot of people don't have or will never have. But it really doesn't matter what you have. As long as you got happiness and family and friends and church, and enjoy it and take advantage of that happiness. Don't let it slip away. Don't let it go by you.
I hear drivers talk about we're going too fast and we're doing this and we're doing that. Well, maybe we are. Maybe we're not. Who's to say? I mean, how do you put a gauge on it? How do you slow? Do you want to race or don't you? I want to race.
Sunday Lincoln Financial Group. Clear solutions in a complex world.
It's here.
Dale Earnhardt was considered by many to be the best NASCAR driver of all time. He was known as the Intimidator for his aggressive style of racing. His black number 3 Chevy was always a car associated with greatness. But on Sunday, the 49-year-old American died in a crash at the Daytona 500. Some 200,000 fans in attendance witnessed Earnhardt's car slam into a wall at approximately 240 kilometers per hour and slide into the infield during an accident on the final turn of the last lap of the race. Earnhardt was taken to hospital shortly after, but according to doctors, he died instantly upon impact due to serious head injuries. At the age of 49, possibly the best known figure in American motorsports history was gone.
This is undoubtedly one of the toughest announcements that I've ever personally had to make. But after the accident in turn 4 at the end of the Daytona 500, we've lost Dale Earnhardt.
He's a Michael Jordan of our sport, and to lose him at this point, as he was going for an 8th championship, and particularly in the Daytona 500, and in particularly the last lap, is incomprehensible. This ranks right up there to me with JFK's death, and it's just a shock.
Now, of course, the racing world was deeply affected by this tragedy. Kyle Petty, who lost son Adam to a racing accident last year, said that you were never prepared for such an event. John Andretti, who has been racing for 3 decades, was also stunned. With more on what Earnhardt meant to the world of sport, here is our John Ginone.
His nickname was positively perfect. Just as Irvin Johnson was magic, Walter Payton sweetness, and Muhammad Ali the greatest, Dale Earnhardt was stock car racing's intimidator. It wasn't just a name, it was a 200-mile-an-hour way of life. Just this week, it was written that Earnhardt would run over his mother, his wife, even his racing son, to pass Richard Petty and become the all-time Winston Cup Point Series champion. It was the way he lived, it was the way he died. At full throttle, on the final turn of the final lap of a race won by a driver in a car Earnhardt owned, with his namesake son right behind. But while his chiseled face and omnipresent dark glasses fed that image, away from the steering wheel, Earnhardt was different. Genteel, kind-hearted, peacock proud of his prodigy, the brash youngster who gladly accepted the specter of his father's footsteps. All right, here he comes. No driver in NASCAR, now or perhaps ever, commanded Earnhardt's level of respect or passionate fanaticism. From the moment he descended on the Winston Cup circuit in 1979, Earnhardt was enormously popular. That will never change, not even now. The abject grief, the makeshift shrines that already dot Daytona, they're all a testament to that. No one in this sport's history had an easier time speeding into victory lane at the birthplace of speed. Thousands of races have been run at Daytona in 42 years. Hundreds of brave men have braced themselves around its fabled high turns and inviting straightaways. Several have tasted success at Daytona. Dale Earnhardt feasted on it 34 times, more than the next two most successful racers combined. That is the Earnhardt legacy. That is why his death on Sunday will leave such a lasting and profound impression. It will raise questions about the sport's safety, about fate, questions with no real answers. Just this week, Earnhardt said the best is yet to come, that there's another championship to win. Sadly, there are no more races for Earnhardt, and for his millions of fans, already dressed in his familiar black color scheme, the mourning begins. At the Daytona International Speedway, I'm John Giannone.
Earnhardt had an illustrious NASCAR career, which spanned over two decades. He was tied for first in Winston Cup titles. He was the leader among active Winston Cup drivers with 76 career wins and was fifth overall in that category. Earnhardt is survived by his four children and wife, Teresa. His death sent shockwaves throughout the United States. President George W. Bush called Mrs. Earnhardt on Sunday to express his condolences over the death of the NASCAR racing legend.
The Earnhardt tragedy overshadowed an otherwise action-packed Daytona 500. The event marks the start of NASCAR's Winston Cup season, and the record crowd in Florida saw a race that had no fewer than 49 lead changes amongst the 14 drivers. Before the Earnhardt crash, with 25 laps to go, Ward Burton gets loose and clips Tony Stewart. Stewart flips through the air, his chassis torn apart. The race was red flagged after a total of 21 cars were involved in this crash on the 175th lap. Stewart lands on the car of Bobby Labonte, causing it to catch fire. From inside Stewart's car, let's see another view. Remarkably, there were no serious injuries from this incident. In the end, eight of last year's top 10 were no longer in the race. 16 laps from the end of this 200-lap race, Michael Waltrip grabs the lead. And after 15 years and 463 NASCAR races, the 37-year-old holds on for his first ever NASCAR victory, coming in this, the Super Bowl of stock car racing. Waltrip is the younger brother of Darrell Waltrip, the winner of the 1989 Daytona 500. He was an emotional spectator as the new champion was crowned. 26-year-old Dale Earnhardt Jr. finished second, and his late father, Dale Earnhardt, was in third spot before the tragic accident. Both the top two Chevrolets were owned by the elder Dale Earnhardt. Rusty Wallace and Ricky Rudd in Fords finished third and fourth.
We now turn our attention to the rest of the